Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
Crossover. Oh, killer crossover.
Just crossover.
It just crossed him over. Nastily.
Another victim to the crossovers. Cross him up and sit him down.
All right, time for the crossover. It's brought to you by Every Little Concrete Repair in Omaha at everylittleconcrete.com. Good to see one of the Vegas boys is back.
Hello. Hello, everybody.
Everybody make it back okay?
Yeah, we're all in one piece.
You had a late Saturday flight, right?
Yeah, we ended up getting pushed about an hour leaving there, which, you know, they don't want. That's the whole thing about Vegas. They don't want you to leave. Yeah. And so I think they do that flights wise, too. Yeah. They're like, yeah, why don't you sit around for another hour?
Stick around. We got slot machines over there.
Throw $100 in the in the Buffalo. Yeah. No, I didn't do that. I didn't buy it.
You didn't take the bait. Good on you.
No, not that time. Yeah. I have before.
Oh, okay.
I have before.
Well, I'm glad to see you guys back in one piece.
Yeah.
Memories of a lifetime.
I
stories
think so.
To tell. The oddest creature you met there that was not Nick.
Oh, man. We met a lot of people, a lot of different people.
A lot of what you would consider odd creatures.
So,
where
you were on the strip on Fremont Street,
yeah,
you probably are more, you're probably going to see a little bit more odd than going down the other way to the major part of the strip.
I tell you what, I don't have, I mean, there's so many good things to say about Circa and how awesome it was. It's like a little slice of the strip on Fremont Street, which I think that's how they're trying to kind of like position it, which is really great. I mean, the place is brand new, but then you go out that door onto Fremont Street, you're like, whoa, I'm in a different world. There's gorillas. There's people in gorilla suits, and there's guys who, I mean, there's people not wearing any clothes.
Yeah.
Everybody's got their phones out and they're taking videos of everything. People doing magic tricks, people doing dances and things like that.
Now,
like, it's a completely different deal.
Now, can you imagine what that place was like for Super Bowl weekend?
Yeah, I cannot. I guess I have a pretty decent idea, but man, I don't think you could really know.
Or what that place will be like for the Vegas A's home opener.
I'm sure it'll be huge.
Yeah.
I'm sure it'll be huge. Yeah.
Even the mayor doesn't want to
miss. We ended up going down to the strip one of the nights.
Last wishes to Tropicana?
I pointed out.
Today is the last day, right?
Those are where the A's are going to be. I think today, tomorrow, it officially closes.
Yeah.
Right? But it looks closed already. And then they're going to wreck it later on in the year, and then they're going to start construction around this time next year, apparently. Allegedly.
Yeah. Yeah. Not if their mayor has anything to do with it.
Yeah.
Go back to the negotiation table in Oakland, please.
Yeah. Weird.
Thinking of you, Oakland fans.
It'd be very odd with a baseball diamond there.
I thought By the way, I thought you would have got more sun.
I did on Wednesday.
And so the first day you got there?
First day we got there, we had to learn how to deal with the sun and all the things. And the left side of my not so much here, more here. Left side of my face got hammered, and then we kind of, you know, you live and you learn. You learn how to deal with it a little bit, which is really nice.
You guys
pulled it back into the cabana a little
bit.
You
guys sounded great. Sounded like a lot of fun.
It was so much fun. It was so much fun. I was glad. I mean, because the music they were playing at the place was really loud the entire time. Yeah. So I was glad that didn't
come over
too much.
Yeah.
Okay. That's good.
No, I guess so. Did we come back with more money than when we left?
That's the important question.
No.
Okay.
No. I think the other two, Nick dabbled in some micro sports betting, I think.
Okay.
Nick sounded satisfied with
tables?
His betting.
I was on blackjack. I took several spins on roulette. I believe Josh dove into craps one night.
Okay. Nice.
And so I think we kind of covered the entire thing. I'm scared of craps.
I don't know
what I'm looking at.
I thought maybe Nick would be a post up in the slot machine.
But they will tell you that craps is the game that you can win the most on.
Apparently. Yeah.
I'm not super comfortable.
Yeah.
I don't understand.
I don't know well enough.
Mentality of craps.
Yeah, I don't either.
And there's a lot of pressure there. When a lot of people around the craps table, there's a lot of pressure.
Yeah. Exactly. With the rolling of I don't know what's what.
Your dice dictates what they're going to win or lose. Yeah, no, I don't need that pressure.
Too much. There's a little bit of that at the blackjack table, too. You got to do the right thing. Make sure everybody stays in the right, on the right path. But yeah, so no, I did lose gambling. I put some money on Creighton. and, you know, kind of when we got there, and then I was up going up to game time, then the odds got better. So I was like, let's just double down here. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, that fell through.
Yeah. Cause it went, what, 2.5 to 3.5?
It went from two in that span that we were there, went from 2.5 to 3.5. It was like 125 in the money line to like 150 on
Friday morning.
I hit the Creighton money line.
Yeah. Yeah. Felt like they would, give it a good run. They did. They lost. They lost.
Did people?
Season's over.
Did people leave you alone? I mean, I saw the sad pizza face.
Yeah. I think they were excited to. My cohorts were excited to watch the game with me, just to feel the stress emanating.
That's cruel.
From my body. But there were no videos that were taken of me, which I'm thankful for.
That's good.
During that period of time, there was other videos during other period of times. Check out Nick's vlog, by the way. 1620 the vlog. A lot of hidden gems in there, Easter eggs, if you will.
So is Nick, is he a returning customer? Did he give you that indication leaving?
Yeah. I mean, yes.
Okay.
Yes. He just has to find the means to do so. Yes.
But will he expect that kind of treatment every time he's out there?
That's a problem right there.
I hope the first time he went, it didn't like ruin it for him.
That's a problem.
Because you can only go down from here.
Exactly. We walked into we got the ride. We walked into the VIP check-in. Hey, can we do anything for you guys? Yeah, so we're you don't get that every single time you go, unless you're big gambler, which I'm not sure Nick is quite yet.
He's learning.
He'll get there.
He's learning. Can we talk about fan behavior at the games yesterday? Did you guys see the Tennessee fan that was smelling their shoe?
I did. Yeah. There was all of a sudden a shoe up against somebody's face.
What was going on with that? Yeah, I saw a screenshot of that too.
There were times they would show the crowd, and I thought it was actually Purdue. It was Tennessee fans dressed as Purdue fans. They like little homie. Okay, but the lady from Tennessee, it looked like there were autographs on her shoe, and maybe
it was just
a
regular old tennis shoe.
And she was holding the shoe up to her face like she was smelling it. I think that's for good luck.
It's just a nervous tick, probably.
To smell your shoe?
Yeah, that's what I usually do. I take off my shoe and I start putting it up to my face. It's just something that I do. Yeah,
smell the shoe.
Yep. Just gotta smell the shoe.
Then there's the other video that is coming out after Kevin Keats got that terrible technical foul yesterday. Did you see the picture of the kid behind him, who is probably, I would say, 8-9 years old, who flips the bird to the official?
I did see that.
They zoomed in on the cab like, oh, yep. He's
like that kid, like
the middle finger going.
When the parents fly back home and he's in school today in Raleigh, Durham, or in suburban Charlotte, cause he looked like a suburban Charlotte kid.
Well, you think so?
do you think that they will walk in and other kids will like give him a standing O, that you became famous because you flipped off an official on TV?
I'd find it hard to believe if there was any NC State fans in suburban Charlotte. I don't think there's any NC State fans in the triangle. You know, it's like, hey, Duke, North Carolina. Yeah, no, I guess we got NC State.
There's a lot of them today.
I guess, yes, there are.
I mean, Jim Balvano's been doing a great job. Man, when he turned it over to Kevin Keats, they never missed a beat.
I remember that like it was yesterday.
I think there's a lot of North Carolina fans that were also very big NC State fans right now, too.
You think so? I don't think you root for little brother.
Yeah, but when they beat Duke?
I think
at least for 40 minutes.
You like teams that beat Duke, but not named North Carolina State.
Be a tough game to watch for UNC fans.
So even for 40 minutes, you guys don't think North Carolina fans were like, come on.
Maybe there's a hint of them who's like, you know what? If Duke feels pain, then I'm
all in. I feel like it softens the blow a little bit.
But there's not a lot of NC State.
Okay, I'd ask this. What would North Carolina fans have more of a distaste for? The fact that NC State's in the Final Four or Duke?
Yeah, Duke being in the Final Four would be painful.
Yeah, that's what I think.
It'd be painful to a lot of America. Minutes.
Yeah, it would.
It would be.
It would.
It would be.
Just there is one thing.
I'm cool with Mr. Burns being there.
Hey.
I love Mr. Burns.
He's not a great matchup for Zach Edey, like from North Carolina State's perspective. But like that's what March is for. Like Jack Golke the week before. You saw him firsthand.
I sure did.
Like the guy.
And I saw Mr. Burns firsthand.
Yeah, that's right. You did, because North Carolina State played there.
So Mr. Burns has this thing now, and he's doing it every single game where he'll like pick somebody in the opposing fan section and just start staring at him the entire game. He continued doing it this weekend. And I don't know if you guys saw the clip where he was like just saying,
yeah,
your season's over. Yep. Your season's over. He is like that. He is very much like that.
He's a big kid playing basketball.
Yeah.
And he's actually having fun doing pretty good. Like there's a review yesterday. it takes a while, and he's at half court dancing. And the game was still kind of like a little bit in doubt.
The guy is enjoying himself. He's got every NIL deal. He's got his line of vending machines that he rolls out. Yeah, that's right. Our man, DJ Burns, is the owner of several local vending machines.
Yep. How cool is that? How many other March Madness heroes do you know that ever had that type of background? None. He's one of one. There's a lot about him that makes him one of one.
He's awesome. I want to get a 6XL DJ Burns jersey.
I was telling Gary.
I just have it go down to my knees.
I felt like maybe he was interrupting spring ball right now because he looks like he should be on the O-line for the Wolfpack.
So Antonio Gates was playing for Kent State and had a good like NCAA game. And look what that did for him.
Mm-hmm.
You don't think because he's got good footwork. You could work on his body a little bit, make him a left tackle for the Wolfpack.
I think that'd be just fine. I don't know how he would use that touch around the rim on the on the offensive line, but he'd figure it out. Maybe he's a defensive lineman. Either way.
He's able to keep those hands inside the frame.
Texter Jesse says, I smelled my shoe through airport security one time, and the TSA agent gave me so much trouble and wouldn't let it go. That's nasty, she said. Embarrassing.
So when he took his shoe off, he actually smelled it?
That's not good. That's not good.
Hold on. Intentionally smelled their shoe at TSA?
No, I think it's unintentional.
Oh.
I think they took their shoe off and then everyone smelled it.
Smelled his odor. Okay. Thought he like, well, I'm curious. Now I got to take my shoe off.
I thought he just gave it away.
Yeah, I got to take my shoe off.
Hey, now that's a real deal.
That's how I read it.
Like, I mean, I'm a pre-check guy. Pre-check guy.
Gary, take your shoes off. Gary, this has been a big, huge success
in Vegas.
Isn't it amazing?
Came in handy
over the last 2 weeks and
best $85 you ever spent, isn't it?
Yeah,
it is nice.
This has been a big changer for me. Life changer.
I just extended mine. I renewed mine. It was up in February. Yeah. It's been renewed. So years of bliss.
I'd like to get the Kevin Keats extension. I'd like to do lifetime contract just because it's worked out for me so many more.
You know what? I would pay a little extra if I could just get a 10-year run as opposed to a 5-year run. Yeah. I'd be like, you know what? $85. Yeah. You know what? Shoot. Charge me $200. I'll do it.
It's been really great going through various airports around the country. It's been awesome.
And everybody looks at you. You don't have to take off your shoes. Oh. You don't have to smell your shoe. You know?
It's awesome. You don't take out your belt. You don't take out your watch. You don't take out your
ring. You feel like a big baller.
Yeah. You just walk. You hand your driver's license. They scan it.
Yep.
And then you're on. You go. To the right, Mr. Sharp.
I had taken a couple those tiny casino water bottles and shoved them in my bag, and I forgot about them, slid them through security, and they were like, dude pulls it out. They were having way too good of a time on Saturday in the TSA line. Guy pulls them out. He's like, all right, $20 a piece for water bottles. We'll bill you. Like, he's yelling this in front of the entire airport. I'm like, okay, give me a break, guy. He's like, oh, I'm just kidding. Like, oh, that's funny.
I'm sure they've seen a lot worse. So.
Yeah. Yes, I would assume so. Yeah.
Have you noticed this? Have you had the privilege of walking by the regular TSA line where it's just backed up to wherever?
I haven't had that in Omaha. That's really been the case because there's only like one lane.
Do you visibly smirk?
I do.
Not intentionally at them, but you just almost like you're proud of yourself.
You flash your boarding pass. Yeah. Like, here's my fast pass. Yep. Look at this.
Have a great time, guys. I'll see you.
Enjoy the line. Side.
Here's my blue laminate card that gets me right through here. I just got to make sure I present that back to the guy on the other side.
8 to 12 minutes in front of you in the coffee line.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah. Sounds
see,
good.
That's what you should do. Anybody need a coffee? I'll be there here in just a sec. If anyone, you know, I'll take some orders.
Scooter line.
Yeah. And it usually is, too. Hey, yeah, that'd be good. Yeah. Anybody need anything?
A topic alert.
Topic alert.
Topic alert.
I hope topic alert stays around.
So this is Billy sent me this earlier, and we didn't get to it on my show.
Come on, Billy.
He said, what would you guys do if, and I'm just reading this. I won't read the whole email, that this is actually something of his. He said, what happens if you live in a house with kids and a dog and you hid 20 eggs and only 19 of them were found yesterday?
Oh, no.
Would this keep you up all night wondering where that last egg was?
Yeah.
And either the kid or the dog are going to find that chocolate.
That'd be like a fun Easter egg for next year.
I would be very unnerved with the dog. Now,
what's wrong with dogs?
They can't have chocolate.
The chocolate is poison.
Dogs can't eat chocolate.
It can kill them. Now, this kills them. It can.
He has one egg that they can't find.
And I'm assuming it's got chocolate in it.
Oh, no.
So this
I didn't know that chocolate kills dogs.
So for this gentleman, this is where I'd say rest easy. So when I was growing up, we had a schnauzer. So it's a pretty small dog.
You killed the Schnauzer?
No.
Oh, okay.
Quite opposite. Now, the Schnauzer, my mom didn't do the best job of hiding the Easter baskets, apparently. And this was like during when she would load us, it was four of us. She would load us up with like four Cadbury eggs and then M&Ms and everything. Our Schnauzer got into the Easter baskets and all four of them.
Yikes.
And ate a ridiculous amount of chocolate. Like all my Cadbury eggs, of course, all mine were gone. And I think all my three other brothers had at least one or two missing. And M&Ms, I mean, probably by a pound of M&Ms were devoured by this, I don't know, maybe a 35-pound dog. Was fine. Was a little wired that day. Was kind of moving a little quick and twitchy.
It's tough.
But was fine. Didn't even have to go to the vet.
Why?
Especially for a smaller dog. That's
Yeah. Very fortunate. Yeah, it's a small dog. And so you most likely will be okay. Especially if it's just one egg. I don't know the size of his dog, but it is still a little bit unnerving.
Theobromine is the main toxin in chocolate. It's very similar to caffeine. Both chemicals are used medicinally as a diuretic, heart stimulant, blood vessel dilator, and smooth muscle relaxant. Dogs cannot metabolize theobromine and caffeine as well as people can.
Yeah.
Wow. Theobromine.
You can survive it, but yeah, it's scary nonetheless.
Don't feed your dogs theobromine. Interesting.
He followed up and he said, he goes, I've looked everywhere. I thought I remembered where I hid all 20.
Yeah.
He goes, I can't find it.
The dog's probably gotten to it then.
It's I said, out. Get rid of the dog.
Time to send the dog away.
Just let him know. He'll probably see it in a day or two and it'll be in the check form of around dog feces.
What was your favorite Easter egg to get? The one with the quarters? Or the one with the...
I got rolled up dollar bills.
Oh, that's really good.
There you go.
Quarters were nice, but I said jelly beans. Yeah,
I love jelly beans.
I was a jelly bean.
I'm in on the jelly beans. If you can give me some like pink jelly beans, green jelly beans, I'm all the way in.
All good. Both good colors.
So this is a trick that was played on me. I could always tell, like, you know, when your mom would make you an Easter basket, that she would sometimes slip in some of the candy that she liked that you didn't like.
Then you get some on the back.
Yeah. Oh, someone's got to eat it.
That's pretty clever.
I have a father who I've never figured this out, and it's really one of his downfalls, and I hold this against him. He is a fan of the black jelly bean and black licorice.
Which I think
I can't get into those.
I think that they should outlaw the clear jelly bean, that white jelly bean, and the black jelly bean.
Oh, the clear one. Good call. I have not even seen that.
Everybody knows somebody who's into black licorice.
I have never understood the fascination with black licorice.
Yeah, it's awful. And if you ever have it in form of Zambuca, even worse.
My dad was the biggest fan of the traditional Twizzlers, but he would never even give the black licorice a chance. It was just, he hated the taste of it.
Oh, it's awful.
He tried it once and he's like, no, I can't. I got only the regular.
Pull question up at Happer Show. Does everyone know someone who's into black licorice?
I don't think I do.
There's always that one person.
I don't think you're right, but I don't think I do.
His name is Walt Sharp. That's who that is.
Oh. That's your guy.
But he liked the black jelly bean. Who likes the black jelly bean?
Nobody.
The black and white jelly beans are worthless.
Yeah.
Why does Brock's Candy continue to put them in a bag?
The white one.
Because you sift through them, and you know what? You separate the jelly beans. You take the pink one, the red one, the purple one. That's the ones you eat. You leave the other ones in there, and the majority of the time, it's the black and the white jelly bean.
Yeah. No, you're right. Orange was always solid. Even if you're not a fan of like orange flavored stuff, the orange jelly bean worked. Red jelly beans always great. Green jelly beans, as Connor mentioned, green jelly bean was always a good one. Purple, you did get the occasional purple one.
So the, what are they? The Jelly Bellies, which expanded. They have lost the number one slot. Starburst jelly beans.
Thank you.
Yep. Starburst jelly beans are the best jelly beans ever.
I agree. I'll give a 1B, and that's Jolly Rancher jelly beans. The Jolly Rancher jelly beans are really, really good too.
But today would be the day to go pick them up at your favorite store because they're going to be half price.
Yep.
Oh, good one.
I used to eat the crap out of Starburst jelly beans. You didn't even need to put it. Don't even put it in an egg. Just give me the bag.
The Starburst family of products is very consistently good.
Mm-hmm, I agree.
I don't think that's a hot take.
I think that's just how it is.
Yeah. Just I find a new product that they've come up with every time I'm browsing through a gas station. I'm like, I'll try that.
They're on point. You're right, Peter. They're on point.
Some of the Skittle, the different kinds of Skittles, not the best, but.
Although you can give me tropical Skittles any day and I'd be happy, man.
Yeah, those
are regular Skittles. Some tasty ones. I'm okay.
Second poll question up. Is the Starburst family of products always good?
It's true. The jelly beans, Gary's right. Jelly beans are, I mean, that's a 5-star right there.
They're usually the first that are gone.
Yep.
Here is John on the Equitable Bank inbox. I love black jelly beans and black licorice.
Mm. How?
You're in a, man.
What happens to your taste buds when that is actually good? I don't get that.
Matt says, Border Collie ate a giant Hershey Kiss. Dog puked that night for about 30 minutes, ooh, but survived.
Oh.
That's a lot of dog.
Yeah, poop. If I remember correctly, our schnauzer had a lot of crazy poops, but I don't think I ever even vomited, because I remember my mom calling the vet and they said just to monitor him, and if he does anything out of the ordinary, then take him in. And other than pooping, which is normal, we all do it.
Sounds
even dogs.
Normal to me.
Yeah, I think they were looking for the vomit thing. If the vomit thing happened, then we'd probably have
to. Yeah, that'd be the red flag probably.
Yep.
All right. Looks like you've adjusted to the time difference, so that's good.
Well, I'm on a lot of I don't know what time anything is.
Oh, yeah. You were on East Coast, then you were on West Coast. Yeah.
Time, day.
You're going back to West Coast?
You're going back out there this weekend.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yep. None of it really makes any sense to me.
You should just spend some time in Mountain Time Zone just for fun.
Yeah.
Hit all the time.
Get them all covered, yeah.
I have returned to understand that our local baseball teams are very good.
Yeah, they are.
And they'll play each other tomorrow.
One's ranked in the top 25.
Why isn't the other one? What?
Big Ten baseball is just out of this world good.
That's good. Considering
I think there's a lot of respect for Big East baseball.
Well, there needs to be more, apparently, because Creighton ranked Creighton now.
I blame UConn.
Everybody's putting up their signs that say rank Nebraska.
There's at least two Creighton. Good teams in the Big East record-wise, and they would rank.
I mean, if they were both ranked, when's the last time they would have played each other when they were both ranked?
In the first game.
In the days of Rosenblatt being packed.
Definitely. Yep.
When both teams were playing for something.
And that last game was in May. It was usually like 1 or 2 weeks before the conference tournament.
Do you think the hate will return since they're both good? Do you think they'll hate each other again?
Yeah.
It could be fun. Because I know the Nebraska team has a bit of an edge to them.
Oh, yes. I know Nebraska does not like them.
Because
and
if
vice
you've
versa.
Noticed on Twitter, it's been a very interesting 2 weeks between Nebraska and Creighton Twitter.
Oh, I've come to understand this.
I found out some yesterday. Nebraska is 0-8 in the NCAA tournament. 128 years of basketball.
Wow, Gary.
I only saw that like 65 times yesterday.
I didn't think you would ever say that, but I'm glad that you're just telling the truth to everybody.
I am telling. They haven't won an NCAA game.
As Nebraska fans were gloating Friday night, they had to be reminded of that.
A program that hasn't won, not a program, but a fan base that hasn't won an NCAA game is infatuated with another one that has won in the NCAA tournament.
A lot.
But is infatuated with the other one.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot going on there. A lot baked into that cake.
So maybe it'll help. And then next year. So, you know, they're trying. I think it's probably Hoiberg and Mack are trying to squelch some of the vitriol that's going on. So let's play on a day that Nebraska football plays.
Yeah. Do we think that that's official?
This is so weird to me.
It seems pretty real.
It is so
weird. So the guy that runs that Twitter account.
He tweeted out the contract.
When the contracts become public and they come through, he tweets out. So they signed a 2-year deal. An extension, and they're going to play on a day that Nebraska football plays a home game. So that game, which last year Creighton played North Dakota State on a football Saturday, and they put it on FS2. That would be disrespectful to put a game, an in-state game between two NCAA tournament teams that played this year on FS2.
Yeah.
Because there's no inventory. I mean, you're not FS1, FS1,
I didn't even think about TV.
I mean, they're all carrying college football.
Right.
Peacock. Well, no, it's a Big East home game.
Because the last 4 or 5 years, they've been Sunday games.
That game will be on Flow Sports.
Have me do it. I'll do it.
On your view.
I'll do it. I'll do play-by-play. I promise.
So I'll
be very neutral.
Unless there's a scheduling conflict at the Chai, I got to think that game maybe gets moved a day.
I would hope so. Two. Yeah, like Sunday.
I feel maybe, like the last five or six games have been Sunday.
Who cares? Do it.
Yeah, they've settled into playing on Sundays,
which is I feel like a good day to do it.
It
was a rare Saturday a couple of years ago, but football was already done.
But yeah, that was in December. Yeah.
Well, they play like on the same day of the Big Ten Championship.
Yeah, either that or the Sunday after. Yeah,
it's like we're going to take our chances
maybe
here.
Maybe when Nebraska negotiated this contract, they're like, you know what, rule is going to have us in Indy, so we don't. You know, want to play?
Well, I'm thinking
that weekend.
Maybe they can't do it the next because Creighton's in battle for Atlantis next year.
Yes, they are.
Is that before that or is that after that?
Well, I thought that was before.
Yeah, because it's usually around Thanksgiving. Yeah. Right. Yeah, leading up to Thanksgiving is.
So I don't think they're coming back from battle for Atlantis and.
Well, is it
in Nebraska?
Isn't the 23rd? So the 23rd is the Saturday before Thanksgiving.
Okay, So maybe year. they
Battle for Atlantis the week before that, maybe?
Or the week after.
Or the week or Thanksgiving.
Battle
week
for here. Atlantis 2024, November 27th through the 29th.
Okay. Oh, so that's over okay. Thanksgiving. Yeah. Yeah. So that I guess that kind of explains why.
They also Creighton also has a return game to Alabama. I'm wondering if that'll be around the same time as this past year.
Yep.
Like middle December. Of December.
That was yep. well, that was November. No, I'm
thinking no, Iowa. 16th. Iowa was Iowa and Creighton was the November one.
There's no more Gavitt game, RIP. Very sad.
Still Big 12 Big East though. Right? Still
big I think there's a Big 12 Big East game in there.
And would Creighton be at home?
Creighton played at Oklahoma State this year.
Yeah, so they should get a home game.
All right. KU, welcome to town.
Oh, and you finished still 10th in the Big 12.
Still one of the unfortunate things of that COVID year is KU and Creighton played
in Lawrence.
And it was a limited crowd down in Lawrence.
Yeah. Yep. And it was like a weekday afternoon too. It was like a
it was very odd.
It was like a Wednesday at 4.
Yeah.
It was really strange.
Strange time.
I remember thinking like I'm not prepared for this. I'm not ready. I'm still in football mode. Things like that. All right. Well, a lot to talk about. We're on to baseball. On to the Royals.
We're a baseball state now.
Go Royals.
Optimistic for 1-2 start.
If they wouldn't have won yesterday, I would have had a problem today.
Especially going to Baltimore.
It felt a lot like the start of last year.
You worried about Cleveland? I mean, they just took it to Oakland.
Not worried about Cleveland. not worried about Cleveland.
Worried about the Tigers?
I am. I picked Detroit to win the Central.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We do have some day games today.
Tariq Skubal, you know, that him and Cole Reagans, that's your Cy Young duo right there. If you take those two versus the rest of the league.
You know what? I'm down on my Cleveland baseball. Don't do Shane Bieber that way, though. Maybe, you see it when he does Shane Bieber?
Put Pablo Lopez in your mouth?
Well, there's a lot of AL Central options, I guess, for
pitchers. Yeah. There's one thing Cleveland can do. They'll throw out a pitcher or two. They just won't hit the ball.
Yeah, they'll go 78.
Also, our guy, I think I told Peter this the other night. So Paul Skeens is scheduled to pitch in Omaha in 2 weeks.
Mm-mm-mm. That means Livy.
Yeah.
Livy! Yeah, come on, Livy. Omaha's beautiful this time of year.
Gary, so, hey, you know we all speculated about when their relationship started? She did a TikTok to kick off baseball season, and she's got an LSU Dunn jersey in her closet and then Paul Skeens' college jersey.
How do you know this? How do you know what's in her closet?
Because she shows up on my TikTok.
Oh, she made
shows up. She has a picture. She has a.
Why does Gary Sharp know what's in Livy Dunn's
She has
closet?
A picture on her like dresser of her and Skeens like taking a picture together at the College World Series on the field.
Maybe you were in it.
I was not.
Oh.
Remember, we all wondered, were they dating at the time?
Yeah.
It appears that they were.
They may have.
We might have our answer.
Maybe it was courtship. Just courtship.
You know what? If you're Paul Skeens, that's a way to do it. Like, why don't you come out and see me play in the College World Series?
And if I'm not pitching, I'm going to throw this giant ball against the wall for 30 minutes. I'm going to drink a bunch of muscle milk.
I mean, Connor,
that guy's a freak.
You know this. I mean, just think. We had games at the College World Series where we had Kim Mulkey and Livy Dunn in the stands at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Kim Mulkey was there last year?
Yeah.
I don't even remember that.
I watched
her. She was overshadowed by Livy Dunn.
As I was walking into the ballpark, she was walking across the street from
she was
lefties.
At the
was she wearing feathers?
No, she was dressed normal.
No, she was. Well, she was in this bright yellow like jumpsuit.
So she was wearing feathers.
But it was like she was Moses because like the fans for LSU just parted ways.
Wow.
And she just walked like into the VIP entrance.
Well, and then of course there was the guy who everyone thought was Ed Orgeron who was having a good time.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
That motorboat and SOB.
that's what Omaha does to
Thank you, LSU. Please come back.
I know.
Please come back.
Jello shots.
Welcome back. Have a good show.
Thanks. I will try. We will try. That is the crossover powered by Everlevel Concrete Repair in Omaha at everlevelconcrete.com. It's Monday. We'll start things off next.
Previously on Unsportsmanlike Conduct.
Would you rather have to eat one hot dog every morning immediately after waking up for the rest of your life, or every time you touch a piece of paper, it cuts you and draws blood?
I would rather eat a hot dog every morning.
Give me that dog.
Kevin says wiping after using the bathroom.
Oh.
Toilet paper. Ouch.
Unsportsmanlike Conduct with John Bishop and Josh Peterson. Weekdays 2 to 6 on 1620 The Zone. Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Cloudy skies for your Monday. Cool today with a high of 48. Northeasterly winds up to 25 miles an hour. 50% chance of showers or an isolated thunder shower here this morning. A bit drier, though, for your afternoon. Cloudy to mostly cloudy skies overnight. The 30% chance of showers before midnight. Breezy, cool, with a low of 36. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV Newswatch 7.
What does Saul's loan on? Almost everything, like jewelry, gold chains, bracelets, earrings, wedding rings, and high-end watches, guns, electronics, $10 to $50,000, super fast and easy with no credit check. Saul's loans on almost everything.
Easy Cater has everything you need to make food for work. Work. From ordering to reporting, we even keep your receipts all in one place, which means all you need to do is sit back and enjoy.
You're not having any lasagna?
All I can taste is hours of expense reports.
Relax, you used Easy Cater. Enjoy the food, Ray.
Oh, no, thanks. That's...
Enjoy it?
That's...
amazing.
Yes, Ray, it is amazing. 100,000 restaurants and everything you need to make food for work, work. Order 24/7 at easycater.com.
When it comes to protecting your home, J. Stennett Contracting takes pride in ensuring every detail is handled. Roofing, siding, gutters. When it comes to the exterior of your home, J. Stennett Contracting has you covered. Have you noticed stains on your ceiling this winter? With storm season around the corner and the damage it can bring, let J. Stennett Contracting ensure that your roof is durable and holds up against the weather this spring and summer. When you need an honest assessment, J. Stennett Contracting has you covered. JSCRestoration.com.
Are you the decision maker in your company? Consider this. For the first time in decades, there's a better option for a corporate card and spend management platform. Meet Ramp, the only corporate card and spend management system designed to help you spend less money so you can make more. Most corporate credit cards offer points as incentives, but those points amount to less than they're worth in real cash value. Ramp's corporate cards offer you cash back, real money in your pocket. Plus, you control who spends what with each vendor, and Ramp software collects and verifies receipts automatically, which means you'll stop wasteful spending and close your books in hours instead of days. Businesses that use Ramp add up to 5% to their bottom line the first year. If you're a decision maker, adding Ramp could be one of the best decisions you've ever made. And now, get $250 when you join Ramp. Just go to ramp.com/sports. ramp.com/sports. ramp.com/sports.
Cards issued by Sutton Bank and Celtic Bank, members of FDIC. Terms and conditions apply.
Are you someone who tries to drive while distracted by your phone? Someone who props it on the steering wheel or peeks down at it for a glance? Or just scrolls and scrolls? If so, you could be the next person to get into a fender bender, get a ticket, veer off the road, or even cause a crash that kills you or someone else. Enough already. Put the phone away or pay. Paid for by NHTSA.
Join me, Jimmy Allen, for the Creighton Athletics Hour. We'll be talking all things Blue Jays and interviewing your favorite coaches, so you don't want to miss it. It's the Creighton Athletics Hour, Thursdays, starting at 6 o'clock, only on 1620 The Zone, 1620thezone.com, and your 1620 The Zone mobile app.
It's the Connor Happer Show with Connor Happer and Josh Otzen. Let's get ready to rumble.
Licensing of the phrase, let's get ready to rumble, just over the last 7+ years internationally is grossed approximately close to $400 million in retail sales.
Really?
You guys look like, what do they look like, Jimmy?
Dorks. They look like a couple of dorks.
On 1620, The Zone.
All right, welcome in. Happy Monday. It is the Connor Happer Show. You're on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. I am Connor Happer. Across from me today is Peter Krenzer, the Peter Man.
Howdy.
Fresh off of a opening weekend for the Omaha Storm Chasers.
The baseball is back.
Where they took two out of three. That was a nice start for them.
Yeah.
Over the weekend, but here we are. Josh is out today, and he will return tomorrow. We have the Final Four that is set. Purdue finally makes it there. They have exorcised their demons, and now they have a chance to win a national championship. But they might have to go through the steamroller that is the UConn Huskies. That would be in the championship game. NC State and DJ Burns makes it all the way home, and Alabama, not a football school anymore, in the Final Four. Your brackets are toast, but honestly, if you're anything like me, you haven't been thinking about that for multiple weeks. I honestly, I haven't really thought about it. I don't even remember what I picked. I haven't thought about it since like the first day of the tournament.
I tend to not check at all the first the first couple weeks, once we get to the Final Four, I just gander and see how I actually did. I predicted one of the Final Four matchups.
Oh, good. Which one? The NC State Purdue one, right?
No. Okay. I did get UConn and Bama. I think on the other side, I had Tennessee and Houston. So didn't get those two. But you know what? I'll take 50%. I usually don't get any of them.
That's not bad at all, Peter. Not bad at all. Peter of brackets.
I think it's a good Final Four.
Call him Peter Brackets, like Joey Brackets. Welcome to a Monday show. We'll talk about the games from over the weekend. Of course, Creighton bowing out in the Sweet 16 on Friday night. We'll take a look at the women's tournament, which has now been marred by several snafus.
Oh, my goodness.
Several snafus, not just the three-point line being shorter than one end. So we'll get into that during the show today. Nebraska and Creighton baseball setting up for a fun one tomorrow night. Football on an aircraft carrier and foods of regions all coming up on the show today. Sam McEwen will join at 1 o'clock as he always does. And the return of one Mike J. Schaefer.
He's back.
Mike Schaefer back on the show, back from the sabbatical after the birth of his first son, which is extremely exciting. And we're excited to talk to him today at 11:30 about a variety of different things and things that he is probably not missed. But what's he been getting into for the last, I don't know, basically 2 months here. So here we go. Here we go. Off and running on a Monday. I want to hear from you guys on the show as always at Happer Show, at Connor Happer on the JTech Construction Zone Twitter feed. You can email Connor or Peter. Do you have a company email? Should people email you?
Hey, if they want to, it's P. Krenzer. That's KRENZER at energymedia.com.
There you go.
If we want to throw that in the ring, there we go.
On the Equitable Bank inbox, you can send us emails there. You can call or text 402-951-1620 on the 42 Degrees of the Source hotline. We say good morning to our YouTube watchers today. There's a lively discussion going on about Creighton and Nebraska and all of those things. We encourage you to join the conversation there on YouTube or conveniently located one click away at 1620thezone.com. It's also streaming on the Happer Show Twitter, on my Twitter, on Facebook, 1620 The Zone's Facebook, and then, of course, like I said, on YouTube as well. Zach emails in on the Equitable Bank inbox. Not everyone's bracket is toast. I have UConn beating Purdue in the championship. I'm glad, and I want to talk about Purdue. And like it's hard for me to take a victory lap on Purdue, considering they were a one seed and, you know, one of the best two or three teams in the country the entire year. But I feel like we got way out of whack with the narratives on Purdue. Obviously, they lost to a 16 seed last year, but I think that is a vastly improved team year over year with their guard play now. Like I had a pretty good sense that they were going to be in a position like this. I actually have them winning. I think I had them winning the national championship. Now, UConn's going to be a tough one, I think.
I had them in the Elite Eight, so I sold them short a little bit. But, you know, I did think they'd be better equipped for They're kind of following the Virginia arc a little bit here. We'll see what happens.
Just a little bit. They do it in a little bit more exciting, exciting way. Although, there is quite the conversation going on surrounding Zach Edey over the last 24 hours and how he's officiated and things like that. We will discuss all of that on the show today. Like I said, want to hear from you guys, and why don't we take a break and we'll come back and we'll get things started with a little bit of Final Four talk on the other side. There's some Nebraska football in here too. I don't think we won't hear anything today out of Nebraska football land, but we will tomorrow when Tony White and Terrence Knighton and selected defenders will speak after practice. We are full into spring ball now. Was hoping basketball could, you know, we still have basketball a little bit, so we can keep our attention diverted. But was hoping that Creighton would hold on another weekend. That way we could just dive full into that. Of course, we'll talk about the Jays as well. More to come on a Monday edition of the Connor Happer Show right here on 1620 The Zone.
Big names, big games. We've got them all. 1620, The Zone.
J-Tech Construction, the official exterior experts of the Huskers, offers exterior solutions that help you protect your number one investment. Whether it's roofing and siding or windows and doors, they're committed to excellence, quality, and outstanding customer service in every step of the process. When it's time to protect the exterior of your home, your choice is simple. Turn to who the Huskers turn to, J-Tech Construction. Check them out online and schedule a free estimate today. J-Tech Construction. The official exterior experts of the Huskers. Are Nebraska craft beers and ciders important to you? Whether you just love Nebraska brewed beers and ciders or you're a full-fledged craft brewery, there are benefits to membership for anyone with the Nebraska Craft Brewers Guild. Their sole mission is to foster and help grow the Nebraska-centric brewing community. Become a member today at nebraska.beer and help advance the craft beer and cider industry in the state of Nebraska. Find out more about the Nebraska Craft Brewers Guild at nebraska.beer.
Without the ones like you who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Howdy, Greg Wagner joining you from the Nebraska Game and Parks Commission. Time now for another Nebraska Outdoor Update. Say there's a lot to do this season in Nebraska's outdoors. There's always hiking in the state parks. There's bird watching. There's trout stream fishing action. There's scouting for that spring wild turkey hunting trip. And there's looking for shed deer antlers in your favorite woods. So there's no reason to be a couch potato, is there? No. Get outdoors and enjoy. Well, it's time to get all your new permits and stamps for hunting, fishing, fur harvesting in state parks. Time to check your motorboat registration for renewal. Time to make those cabin and camping reservations in the state parks if you haven't done that already. And time to go over all of your outdoor gear for spring and summer. Get more information on Nebraska's outdoor scene by going to the Game and Parks website, outdoornebraska.gov. And that'll wrap it up. I'm Greg Wagner with Nebraska Game and Parks.
Email on sportsmanlike conduct on the Equitable Bank Zone Inbox with whatever is on your mind, from your hot takes to what you think is one. The Zone Inbox is brought to you by Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. We want to hear from you on the Equitable Bank Zone Inbox.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that we can give our daughters everything they need to grow and learn. But not every child can focus on classes and play dates.
Nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. face hunger. That's 1 in 6. School lunch might be their only meal each day. And it's heartbreaking to imagine any child going to bed hungry. We're dreaming of a perfect day when kids can smile, play, and just be kids without worrying about where their next meal will come from. Feeding America is working to make that perfect day a reality.
Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste. That food is given to families and children in need. Being a kid should be about doing things that make an ordinary day extraordinary. Learning to play an instrument, building a sandcastle, hosting tea parties. Hunger should never be an obstacle to growing up.
You can help end childhood hunger in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
We're going abroad for the first time in years. To Spain.
But we don't speak Spanish.
So we started using Babbel.
And started learning Spanish fast.
With Babbel, you can start having conversations in another language in just 3 weeks. Babbel's conversational method teaches you real-life words and phrases. And with Babbel's interactive bite-sized lessons, you'll remember what you learned.
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿De dónde eres?
¿De dónde eres?
When you learn a language, you want to actually use it. Babbel is designed with that goal in mind.
In just 3 weeks, we're starting to have conversations in Spanish.
Estoy muy emocionado para ir a España contigo.
Aw, he just said, I'm very excited to go to Spain with you. Nos vamos a divertir mucho.
And that means we're going to have a lot of fun.
Sí. Gracias, Babbel.
Babbel, language for life. Celebrating 10 million subscriptions sold. Now try Babbel for free at Babbel.com. Just go to Babbel.com and start learning a new language today. That's Babbel.com. Babbel.com.
All right, here's a tweet that I saw going around yesterday after Purdue clinches a spot in the Final Four for the first time in more than 40 years. That's from Jeremy Frank at MLB Random Stats. What does this have to do with Purdue? Here you go. Purdue basketball and the Cubs both win on the same day, March 28th, 2019. The Cubs beat the Rangers in Texas, and Purdue beats Tennessee 99-94 to reach the Elite Eight for the first time in 19 years. March 31st, 2024, just a little over 5 years later, the Cubs beat the Rangers in Texas, and Purdue beats Tennessee 72-66 to reach the Final Four for the first time in 44 years. Baseball, there's always something.
It's always a threat.
There's always a step. Zach emails in on the Equitable Bank inbox on Purdue. He says the level of physicality and rebounding across the board, not just 80, is pretty underrated. And that game yesterday would have been an absolute blowout if Purdue wouldn't have shot like 60% from the free throw line. I couldn't help but notice, it was coming from the Tennessee game on Friday night, and that Creighton was in. I think there was a level of physicality in that game, and Creighton doesn't, admittedly, Creighton does not bring that piece really to the table all that much. Now I'm going to talk about Creighton and what they did and what they did not do on Friday night here in just a little bit. But if you carry that over to Purdue on Sunday afternoon, Tennessee against Purdue on Sunday afternoon, it just, there was a little bit more of that. And so it was interesting to watch Tennessee. From the Creighton Homer perspective, like Zakai Ziegler was so good on Friday night, and then he had pretty much the same looks on Sunday and, didn't knock a lot of them down. But like I said, we'll talk about Creighton from the Creighton perspective here in just a little bit. But the conversation surrounding Zach Edey today and Purdue today is just, it's really odd to me. I don't like the guy had 40 points in an Elite Eight game. That's pretty good. And still we have we always go back to the narratives and all that stuff. Like he was really, really good in that game. And now I see all these videos of him, they're like, well, how long was he in the lane on this play? I mean, the guy is so good. It's the move in his bag, right? He's going to post up, and Tennessee's going to be really, really physical with him, and he's going to shoot a lot of free throws. I would have been super curious to see what would have happened in a Creighton game where Creighton doesn't foul. Tennessee does. I mean, they're that physical. They will try to really be up in your face and guard you and grill you for the entire game. Not the way Creighton does it, and they kind of hang back a little bit. But Edey versus Kalkbrenner would have been so much fun to watch, and Tennessee isn't necessarily equipped from that perspective, to deal with the overwhelming sort of nature of Edey. But watch him. Like, there's some people watching the videos, and they're like, well, look at him in the lane, just camping out for 9 seconds. No, if we're watching the same video, he's taking a couple steps out of the lane, he's popping back in, he's resetting, he's grabbing it again, he's learned how to pass out of the post. He's done a pretty good job there. And then, of course, he's a, really, I don't know how instinctive, whatever, all the things that you need to be in order to be a good rebounder. He doesn't need to be any of really a lot of those things, just because he's so tall, he's so big, but he clears so much space by himself and he does such a good job. I don't get it. I don't get it with Edey. I think he's awesome. I think he's really good. I think he can be frustrating to watch sometimes because he is so large. And people are like, well, he doesn't shoot, and he's not high flying, and he's when he dunks, he's not jumping off the ground very much. But like, he is such an impactful player. And then Purdue doesn't get to where they go without their awesome guard play with Smith and Lawyer and Jones. And those guys have been really good. And then the defensive physicality that Gillis brings to the table, like I it's not surprising to me. I know they're a one seed. It's not surprising to me that Purdue has ended up in the Final Four. And I don't think it should be surprising to anybody else either.
I, for one, am very excited. I did not think we'd get to this point, but I'm very excited we're going to get Edey and Burns locking up in the Final Four.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know how often we'll see them just posting up against each other, but it's going to be
a lot. I think we're going to see it a lot.
I think that's probably going to be the most likely matchup down there, but I'm very excited.
They are two people who clear a lot of space. They clear a lot of space for themselves. That's for sure. They are, yeah. That I think that'll be fun. I think that'll be more fun probably for Edie, just with his size. I don't know if that's a fantastic matchup for him.
Yeah, there's truly nobody that.
But Burns could get a lot of, you know, Burns has so much good touch around the rim, and like I said, he's pretty good at clearing out space as well. But there might be some fouls between those two.
Mm-hmm.
I would assume. So watch out for foul trouble kind of early in that game. Chris in Montana writes in on the text line. Do you think that the SEC crybaby effect added on to the Zach hate this weekend? Absolutely. Yes, I do. Indeed, I do. You know, the SEC has carried over a lot of the football stuff to the basketball side when their teams make a run into that category. And they're like, yeah, well, you know, this is the SEC. We're the best at everything. And it's like no other league like exists. And to a certain extent, every league sort of has that. But yeah, there is that mentality on social media after the games and stuff like that as well. I don't, mm-hmm. you know, I don't get it with Purdue. I think that's a really good team. And I think I've been calling this for a long time now, but I don't feel like I need to take a victory lap on it. Cause I think they're, you know, they've been one of the best teams in the country all year, but the narrative surrounding them has just been so out of whack for me. And then it has bled into Edie as well, who is the most impactful player in the country and is going to be the national player of the year again. And for good reason, he is the best player in the country. He's the most impactful player in the country. He is all of those things. And so, you know, Greg and Lincoln, Purdue fan, I stand with you today, my friend. I stand with you. I'm kind of rooting for Purdue. And then we have the whole conference cheering thing, which is a lot of fun. I know our good friend John Bishop had some fun with that. With UConn just destroying everything that was in their way with the help of a 30-0 run on Sunday against Illinois, or Saturday against Illinois. Sorry, my internal clock is all messed up.
We don't think Connor knows times right now. It's an adjustment period.
I think it's 10:53 and it's Monday and I'm here. That's what my computer says anyway, so that's good. I don't know who the hell is going to beat UConn. I really don't. With all that said about Purdue, and I do hope we get UConn-Purdue in the final, and I guess we had been sort of theorizing throughout the finale of the regular season and then into the postseason, like, what is the right kind of team to beat UConn? You go into these games, and you know, Alabama, if they shoot really well, is going to have a chance. But you go into an NCAA tournament game and you look at the matchup, and you know, we do this with how we predict football games or whatever it might be, and we say, okay, you're going to get an average performance. Let's just say you're going to get an average performance from the team, and that's how you decide who's better and who's not as good. But we all know it. Sometimes you just play better, and sometimes you just play worse. And the fact of the matter is, with UConn right now, in order for them to lose, they're just going to have to be off. And I don't even know how you do that, considering most of what they do is from like an emotion. Obviously, they're so good from a talent perspective, but they bring that edge, that hard edge, and that emotion to the table that really, really puts them over the edge against anybody else. I mean, they are crazy. And they're crazy because their coach is insane. He's an insane person. He's everything, everywhere, all the time. And so the fact of the matter is, they're just going to have to be off in order for somebody to beat them. And somebody else is going to have to be at their best. And let me say this, and I said it last week as well. I love Dan Hurley. I do. And I know the Big East, you know, fans that Creighton is included in have had a lot of, you know, with the dust ups with Dan Hurley. Like, he could say whatever he wants right now, including that his own fan base is, quote, obnoxious as bleep on social media. He said that the other night. He's like, everyone hates us. He keeps talking about how the committee tried to make it as tough as they possibly could on him and more ammunition in that regard. Like, I don't even know that anything that he says is like he actually means. It's all just a ploy and stuff that he says in the media to get his team to have an edge, to get his team to play harder. And like, cause I mean, look at them. They've lost three games all season. They've been the best team in the country all year long. They won the national championship last year. And all that we're talking about is, you know, like they very easily could have rested on their laurels and said, yeah, we're the, and they very well could have won the national championship that way and just said, we're the best team in the country. We have elite player here, elite player here, elite player here. We're just physically better than everybody else. Like they could probably win the national championship that way. But what puts them over the top is their edge and their coach talking all of the time. He is insane. He's an insane person.
He is.
And I really like it. I don't know. I think he's, you know, people always say they're like, oh, you know, he's good for the game, or this person's good for the game, or this person's bad for the game. I don't know what he is for the game. All I know is that he talks the talk and then his team backs it up. And I think a lot of the times he's just trying to test his team from an emotional standpoint. I watched his video last night that was going around of what it's like at a UConn practice on a day-to-day basis and just how hard it is and how intense it is every single day. Like that is the edge that they have right now. And I think it's very rare to sustain something like that for an entire season. And they have done it. They've sustained it for the entire season. And you know, you can go back to that Creighton game, which was the last game that they lost here in Omaha when Creighton stormed the court and everything. Like they were fine that night too. I just thought Creighton played really, 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 mm-hmm. really well. It was kind of the 40 minutes of magic type of thing that we talked about with Nebraska beating Purdue earlier in the season. Like 40 minutes of magic, they just put it together. That could be their ceiling that they reach. You can't expect that though. You can't expect a team to have an edge like that every night. UConn has an edge every single night. Every night it is, and they're all over you. Like it's, The run is 10-0, and the run is 12-0, and the run is 15-0, and the run is 18-0, and they're still getting after it. They're up by 30. They get the run to a 30-0 run in an Elite Eight game against a really good team, and they're like taking shots down the court. Still, they are pushing and they are pressing, and they're doing like that is an impossible team to go against. Impossible when they have that kind of edge to them. That's what puts them over the top. They are so much fun right now. And then you have NC State, who, I mean, I will remind people, as many have,
shot out of a cannon
over the last 48 hours here. Remember, NC State needed a missed Virginia free throw in the ACC semifinal game when they were down by three with like 5 seconds left, followed by a buzzer beater to send it to overtime in the ACC semifinal to even make this possible.
That touched every part of the rim before it went in.
If not there, we never hear of this. This is not a thing. They go on to win the ACC final, and then they have ripped through their first four games of the NCAA tournament. Unbelievably. I got to see him up close in Pittsburgh when Creighton was there for the first weekend. They were I still don't think there's anything special about them. I still don't think there's anything special about them. They just win.
They're just clicking when the time is right for it.
And sometimes when you get to the NCAA tournament, you need a little bit. And they've slayed giants on their way to the Final Four here a little bit as well. But like sometimes you need a couple breaks to go your way, and you get the combination of all those things, and you have a fantastic run, and they are in the Final Four as an 11 seed. Which is awesome. I mean, it's been amazing.
What did it say? First time since 83 when they won the title. It looks like over 40 years.
Yes, that is right, Jim Valvano. You remember that, quite well. So, and then I guess we could talk about Alabama as well, but I don't know that like there's a whole lot of storylines with them. There is the slight local angle, I guess, to them and what they've done. With Charlie Reitzel on that team, and they're going to get him back, for the Final Four, which is good, coming off of that concussion. But, Alabama just beating Clemson. Like, nobody was interested in that game.
Wait, this isn't the college football playoff.
I don't think anybody was particularly interested in the Alabama-Clemson game, but I'm excited that that Alabama is there as well, because they pose an interesting sort of matchup, I guess, for UConn. Josh writes in on the YouTube. He says, 1620, the Husky. Lots of love for UConn from this station over the past few days. Like, they are a heel program,
and we're in WrestleMania season, of course.
So, like, I find them hateable, and I find them, like, you know, if I was looking at this, like, if I thought Dan Hurley actually meant most of the things that he was saying, then I'd be like, wow, this is a deplorable team. I don't like them. They're not fun. They're like robotic in their effort. They are, you know, they're everything that you want to I just think they're everything that you want a basketball team to be. Like, they are not only, so let me defend my love of UConn here real quick. Like, they are not only one of the most talented teams in the country with Newton and Klingon and everybody else that they'll run at you, and even they're deep outside of that too, and they'll throw different looks at you. They can win games in varieties of different ways. That's why it's so hard for me to come up with like something that, like, what's the type of team that they can beat them, because they can run and they can shoot and they can slow things down and they can play physical. So it's very rare that a team comes along and they have the ability to do all of those things. They check every single one of those boxes. A lot of times when we talk about college basketball, especially around here, where our local teams aren't as talented as that, we talk about them having to win in a certain way. This is what they want to do in order to have a chance, right? They want to slow things down. They want to speed things up. They want to shoot the ball well. They want to, you know, get post touches. They want to get to the free throw line, whatever it might be. UConn, like, they don't have that. They can win in all of those ways, and they have showed it. I guess the only real mark on them so far is they haven't really played any close games. We don't know how they're reacting in late game scenarios quite yet. Maybe we'll find out at some point in the Final Four. But not only do you have that tied into a nice little bow for UConn, you also have this is what sets them apart. It's so rare that you have a team that is that good and that could win all of those ways and is that talented, but also has the edge to them like they've never won a damn thing in their lives. That's what I believe is endearing to me about them, because they could very well be walking into every arena that they play in and say, we're the best team here. We're going to walk through and we're going to win just based on the fact that we have Donovan Klingon and we have Tristan Newton and Cam Spencer, and like, we're good. They could do that. They could absolutely do that. They're one of the more talented teams, you know, 1-5, obviously, in the country. But what sets them apart is that they don't. And I think this makes them endearing. They approach it like they haven't won anything. They won the national championship last year. They were the best team in the Big East this year by far. They were, they have ripped through every NCAA tournament game by 100 points. Mm-hmm. Like, don't you think that's a little endearing? Don't you think that's cool? Like, they could be the Yankees and just say, well, we're the Yankees, you know, we can do anything we want. Or they could be, like, I don't know what a good example of that would be. They could just, you know, and a lot of times you catch those teams sleepwalking. UConn hasn't been caught sleepwalking one time.
It's the easiest sport to have one bad day that crumbles down an entire year, and they just haven't had it. They haven't won every game, but they have been from,
maybe you could argue that they
beginning to end.
Maybe you could argue that they sleepwalk a little bit at Kansas or at Seton Hall, I guess, earlier in the season. Yeah. I could tell you that they weren't sleepwalking at Creighton. Creighton just played really, really well. Right. And I don't know specifically on the cases of Kansas and Seton Hall, their other two losses on the year, but they haven't done that one time. There haven't been like, yeah, we're UConn and we're number one and, you know, whatever. We'll just probably win today and that's it. Nope. I think that's cool. Like, I think that's fun. And so I'm dying for a Purdue-UConn national championship game, because I think those are the best two teams in the country. And I think Purdue would give them the best shot from a personnel standpoint. But I know Purdue doesn't have that edge. And so if they could pull through this, like, if they could pull together an unbelievable performance They could definitely win that game, but it's so hard to against that team because they give you nothing. They give you nothing. Everything is closed all the time. Like all roadblocks are closed. That's how it kind of felt, you know, when Creighton was playing Tennessee on Friday night as well. Like I said, want to hear from you guys on the 42 Degrees Source Hotline, 402-951-1620. Feel free to call or text into that number. We'll talk about plenty of other things. Let's move on here and get over to the Jays and the end of their season. I have a question about the future as well. Mike Schaefer will join us at the bottom of the hour. Sam McEwen still coming up in the 1 o'clock hour. There is plenty headed your way in the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio, this is 1620 The Zone.
College basketball's biggest tournament is coming, and it's time to start betting like a pro with the world's largest sports book right at your fingertips. Circa Sports Iowa. It's sports betting the way it should be. High betting limits, tight money line splits, exceptional customer service, and more. Fund and bet like a pro anywhere, anytime. It's never been easier. Download your new bookie before all of the March action at circasports.com. If you or someone you know may have a problem with gambling, call 1-800-238-7777.
Sometimes I just cannot believe all the storms we've gone through here. I can only hope that we'll be able to leave this house to you one day, baby. You're our legacy.
Planning for these disasters will make sure we're safe and is the best way to protect that legacy.
Protect your legacy. Visit ready.gov/plan for the tools and tips you need to start your emergency preparedness plan today. Brought to you by FEMA and the Ad Council.
When it comes to protecting your home, J. Stennett Contracting takes pride in ensuring every detail is handled. Roofing, siding, gutters. When it comes to the exterior of your home, J. Stennett Contracting has you covered. Have you noticed stains on your ceiling this winter? With storm season around the corner and the damage it can bring, let J. Stennett Contracting ensure that your roof is durable and holds up against the weather this spring and summer. When you need an honest assessment, J. Stennett Contracting has you covered. JSCRestoration.com.
When I heard the words, you have breast cancer, I said, I have no idea what I'm going to do. My OBGYN called me and said, I know exactly what we're going to do, which led me to Nebraska Cancer Specialists. From day one, I felt that I was at the right place. There were some pretty rough times, but together we are stronger and they are there for you. You do not feel that you are alone.
NebraskaCancer.com.
Small business owners, we know finishing your to-do list can feel like climbing a mountain, but that mountain is also covered in banana peels. Then, when something new gets added to your list, you're like, nope, I'm already climbing this huge, super slippery banana peel mountain of a to-do list. At Progressive, we don't want to make your day any harder. That's why we make it easy to manage your policy on our mobile app. So climbing that banana peel mountain feels more like a leisurely stroll. See if you can save on commercial auto insurance in as little as 6 minutes at ProgressiveCommercial.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Coverage subject to policy terms and conditions.
High schoolers, unleash your creativity and learn about potential careers in broadcasting at the Digital Expressions Media Camp. Have fun, make friends, and get hands-on experience with video and radio production June 9th through the 14th at the University of Nebraska at Kearney. Scholarships are available from the Nebraska Broadcasters Association, and spots are limited. Learn more at digitalexpressionscamp.com. That's digitalexpressionscamp.com.
Prescriptions require an online consultation with a healthcare provider who will determine if appropriate. Restrictions apply. See website for details and important safety information. Subscription required. Price varies based on product and subscription plan.
Hey guys, did you know there's a generic form of Viagra that works just the same but is 95% cheaper? And you can get it online at hims.com/radio. Through Hims, you'll get a free medical consultation to determine the ED medication that's best for you. Discreet shipping if prescribed, a 100% online process, and a range of treatment options, including trusted generic alternatives to the name brands, at up to 95% off. ED is personal, and at Hims, so is treating it. Just go to hims.com/radio and get connected to a licensed medical provider online for free. With zero copay, no expensive appointments, and no awkward face-to-face conversations. To start your free online visit, you need to go to this exclusive address, hims.com/radio. That's hims.com/radio for your free online visit, hims.com/radio.
The Zone Hotline is powered by 42 Degrees, the source, by your mom's house.
Tickets for less. Best seats, best prices, no service fees. Shop ticketsforless.com. KOZN Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
All right, welcome back for the Connor Happer Show here on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. Connor Happer and Peter Krenzer with you. You know what, Peter? I want to get into Creighton here in a second. I haven't even addressed I've been out of town so much lately. Like, I haven't even addressed what I'm going to do to watch. How am I going to watch the Kansas City Royals this year? Because I've only been in town for one of their games, and I was watching the Elite Eight game yesterday, so I didn't really feel the need to watch them. How am I going to watch them? I have no idea.
Last year
I was a cable boy, and I had
and you have cut the cord.
I had the Bally. This year I am of YouTube TV. And they do not.
They
have,
don't carry local because I don't. I'm not well versed on the YouTube TV.
They have local stations. But they don't have their deal with Bally didn't work unless I missed something. Oh, that's
right. I remember that was a big topic.
And so I thought. So by the way, I'm crowdsourcing this.
I believe
I need help. So like, weren't they going to do a deal with Amazon? I thought they were going to do a deal where all their stuff was going to be on Prime Video.
I think they need to do a deal with somebody because aren't they bankrupt? Isn't Bally like?
Yeah,
not doing great.
I don't know the ins and outs of that. It's possible. I'm not sure. I've heard a lot of things over a long period of time now, but this is the first time I've actually like mentally addressed this in my head. How am I going to watch my favorite baseball team this year? Which another hearty shout out to Major League Baseball. We love Rob Manfred. He's so good at this. I was talking to the people in the Vegas Insider guys had me on one of the mornings, Friday morning, I think, in Vegas prior to the Creighton game. And they asked me a very important question. They asked, how many MLB teams are you blacked out from? And I said, just one. But if you go, I believe 2 hours to our east, it's like five, where it's basically everybody in the kind of like, you know, around the triangle. Where it's the Royals and the White Sox and the Cubs and the Cardinals and the Twins. I think they're all blacked out there. But they told me that Las Vegas is blacked out from seven baseball teams.
Almost one third.
Just wait. Just wait. I guess when the A's move there, it'll be the same amount. But because apparently they're blacked out from Bay Area teams. Which is we looked it up. It's a 9-hour drive from from Las Vegas to the Bay Area. So
why
like,
do they not want anyone to watch their products?
Exactly. Thank you, Rob Manfred. You're very good at this. You have healed this sport greatly. We have TV deals that are absolutely all over the place. And yet, you know, my dad has MLB TV because he likes to watch the Yankees. And
The Royals are blacked out on that, aren't they?
The Royals are blacked out on MLB TV.
Okay.
And so I'm trying to figure out my best course of action.
This might be an option.
Help me, Peter.
I'm not positive the blackout restrictions. I don't think there should be any. Bally has a package for non-cable users.
So it's an a la carte?
A little a la carte option. You get Thunder, Timberwolves, and Royals games. $19.99 a month or $189.99 a year, which seems a little steep.
Yeah, Channel 3 Sean says the same thing. He says you have to subscribe to Bally Sports Plus. It's about $20 a month, but you can stream it. It's the only option.
And we all know how great Bally's streaming works.
$20 a month? So if I go up to $20 a month, let me just play this out for you guys. If I go up to $20 a month, and I still have my YouTube TV, and then I still have the internet. Like, all that combined basically just gets me back to the price that I was paying, which was an exorbitant amount for cable. At that point, I would just go back to cable.
Yeah.
So you're telling me my best course here is to probably just attach the cord again, reattach the cord. I kind of like this YouTube TV life. It's nice.
I have a lot of recording options. Like, it's fast. Strike a deal.
It's so dumb.
Because I know more and more people that are on the YouTube TV train, but they have the sports issues.
Joe says he lives in Kansas City and he has YouTube TV. He says, I pay $19.99 a month for the Bally Sports app. Ugh. Ugh. Okay. So thanks.
We're back to square one.
Yeah. By the way, I like Scott's suggestion too. I'll keep this one under wraps, but I will. I have thought about Scott's suggestion into me right here, just so you know. My wife tweets into the show. Hello, my wife.
My wife.
Maybe if we go back to Cox, then they will give us a deal. Maybe.
We're back and we're here to negotiate.
I can't tell them that I need those. Like, I can't tell them, like, hey, look, I need the Royals.
I need my face.
Because then they'll just take advantage of it.
Because then they'll be like, all right, well, we'll hike it up a little bit.
This sucks. That's all I have to say. Thank you for your help. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Rob Manfred.
I don't know that we've got anywhere today, but this really is not fun for me. This is the first time I'm mentally approaching this. Because I watched them in the airport from Vegas on MLB TV on Saturday before we left. And I was like, wow, this is great. I could just click and it's there. So I don't know. But I'm getting some other options that are sent to me as well. I appreciate it. I'll sift through your responses after the show. Hopefully this is helpful to me, but I really don't want to reattach the cord, and I definitely don't want to pay $20 a month to watch the Royals. I can't think of a worse thing to do with my money. I love my team, but I can't think of a worse thing to do. On Creighton from Friday night, they bow out in the Sweet 16 to Tennessee, 82-75. Baylor Shireman had 25, and you know he was keeping Creighton in it for quite some time. Dalton Connect ended up being a little bit too much, but some of their ancillary guys, I mean, Ziegler was really good, made a whole bunch of those mid-range kind of pull-ups. He didn't come off the floor for a minute either. So the game was really physical, and you know, I think Creighton was pretty thrown by that, and that, you know, they hit a 18-0 run, obviously, which Creighton almost climbed all the way back from, and you know, ended up falling a little bit short at the end. There was that tip ball that should have been probably out of bounds on Tennessee. I just thought generally, and I think there's a whole bunch of stuff like specifically in the game that we can get into where Creighton was good, where Creighton was bad, and we'll try and hit on a couple of these here in the next few minutes. But I just thought generally, Creighton got a little bit timid, and especially after those first four, they turned the ball over four times in the first few minutes, and there was just some dumb stuff. And we talked about it, you know, all the in the lead up to the game, in the week lead up to the game, like they just can't turn the ball over. They're gonna blitz you on defense. They're gonna be right up in your face. And to Tennessee's credit, I mean, they made it really tough for Creighton to get any halfway decent look, but then, you know, like I said, you have shot makers and they were making plays. I mean, Baylor Shireman was keeping Creighton in it for a long time. Ashworth got loose on a couple of threes. He finally got some open ones to go down. But I just thought generally Creighton was just a little thrown by the physicality and a little timid, especially after those first four turnovers in the first few minutes. And ultimately, you know, it sunk him. I was sitting there like with a Creighton shirt on, thinking, man, can we get a foul call? They're all up in their face the entire game, and you know, nothing was really going that way for them. And then I heard all the conversation. I was briefly checking Twitter a couple times. I was like, oh, Creighton only has, there's people sitting behind us at the stupid sports book, and they were like, what's the deal? Creighton only's got two fouls in this half. And I'm like, watch ball, just watch. This is the best, you know, the best team in the country at not fouling. They do not foul. This is how they play it. And so it was always going to be an interesting matchup for that perspective. And you know, Creighton just had to do more offensively. They ended up turning the ball over 9 times to Tennessee's 4. Creighton assisted on only half of their made baskets, which isn't a terrible number. Like statistically, it doesn't come out looking that bad, But it was pretty much right after Creighton grabbed that lead, 39-38 at the start of the second half, and he started to feel good about themselves, that Tennessee just hit that massive run. And, you know, when you get something like that going in the NCAA tournament, and I thought, you know, much like Nebraska and their loss to Texas A&M in the NCAA tournament, I just thought Creighton got maybe a little bit sped up. And I know that's more of their game, but, you know, they are pressuring and they are pushing at all times. And Creighton just could have, I think, afforded to during that time in which the 18-0 run is happening to them, like, because it happened in a flash. I thought during that time they could have afforded to maybe hang on. Let's take a deep breath. Let's slow things down. Let's get a good shot. But their Tennessee's pressure and their intensity really made that difficult for Creighton to just be able to slow down, because they knew the only way. I mean, Creighton shot a better percentage from the field for the record, but obviously the turnovers made it so they shot less. But like their pressure, their intensity, it just wasn't, it did not allow Creighton to slow down their mental clock, I don't think. And, you know, they ended up taking some bad shots from it as well. Jeff on the text line says, tough look for future NBA star Trey Alexander to have one of his worst games. That Trey was not good. By the way, I don't know that anybody's calling like a future NBA star, but you know, he's going to test the waters again. I don't know if that game changes his outlook in particular. But you know, certainly didn't help his draft stock, but yeah, he was pretty timid in that game, and he was a non-factor for the majority of it until, like, of course, as God would have it, he makes a couple threes at the end of the game. Yeah. You know, that's kind of the way it goes from that perspective. But no, it wasn't a good day for Trey, and they couldn't afford for him to not have a good day. And, Baylor picked up some of that slack, and Kalkbrenner picked up some of that slack as well. But, they made the Sweet 16 again, and I think it was a painful afterwards. But then once again, you look back and you say, well, that group basically, you know, won a game in the NCAA tournament that first year. They went to the Elite Eight last year, and they went to the Sweet 16 that year, this past year. And that was, you know, that was a pretty awesome run.
Getting to that stage in 3 out of 4 years is something every single college basketball program would absolutely love to do.
Yeah.
But some will not. And I don't think that
you always want more.
I don't think that should be over. But yeah, and you know, when you get to the Elite Eight last year, obviously you come up around short. You wanted to get there. But overall, this core group has,
well,
had tremendous success.
Absolutely. And Ryan Kalkbrenner is the greatest, you know, winner in the NCAA tournament in Creighton basketball history. And Trey Alexander is right behind him. So yeah, those are two guys on that team. And we could talk a little bit more later about, you know, defining season success versus tournament success. Max said after the game, and I thought it was pretty poignant, like, hey, sometimes the hardest thing to do is what you're expected to do. And that was pretty much what that team was expected to do, even though we knew the ceiling was, I think, a little bit higher than that. But and later on, I also want to talk about maybe we hold this because we're going to talk to Schaefer for a few minutes. I want to talk about the future too. I asked a question on Friday on the show, before the game, like this, like Peter just said, I mean, with Trey's future in doubt and with Kalkbrenner's future in doubt and with Ashworth's future in doubt and Baylor is gone, like that was a pretty spectacular run for those guys in the 2 or 3 years that they were here, or one, I guess, in Ashworth's case. But I think I kind of expect him back at this point. We'll see. By the way, congratulations to him. He's going to the 3-point contest, not the dunk contest. So it'll be Steven Ashworth versus Keisei Tobinaga in the 3-point contest, which will be a lot of fun.
That'll be fun.
Maybe we could talk about that a little bit later. But it's sort of a reset. Maybe it's a soft reset. Maybe it's a hard reset next year, depending on what Trey and Kalkbrenner do. You know, and now Creighton has continued to build and build and build to the point, and maybe it's a crescendo what they're in right now. Maybe that was as good as it's going to be. But I will mention this. I've also thought that like 10 other times in the last 12, you know, 14 years of Greg McDermott, like, hey, this is as good as it's going to be. It will never be this good again. You will never find a group. You'll never get this. You will never find a group like this that comes together and stays together. And so I want to ask the question, like, has Mac proven it enough times to us that Creighton will continue to look like this and be this type of program going forward, even in the future, or even continue to continue to ascend from here? I don't know what the future holds, but man, I'm pretty excited to see what it looks like. By the way, so also in that 3-point contest, Jack Gulkey, Stephen Ashworth, Keisei Tominaga, and Jack Gulkey.
Oh, that's awesome.
I actually might watch this.
I think I might
for the first time in history. I might watch.
Is it Friday night or Saturday?
Hold on, I gotta find the tweet again.
That's gonna be awesome.
Let's see. It's always the weekend of the Final Four. So this week at GCU Arena in Phoenix, I got the release.
Oh, we're in front of the raucous GCU fans.
Yeah, those people are nuts. This will be Thursday. This will be Thursday. April the 4th. The 3-point contest will be at 8 Central on ESPN.
I'll have to tune in.
Quite possibly appointment viewing. All right, we'll come back. The return of Mike J. Schaefer. Husker 24/7 coming up next on 1620 The Zone.
Mornings with Sharp and Handley.
I wanted Nebraska to settle in, make some shots early, and then get into a moderate pace because they're not built. Like, start with their Air Jordans and then slip on the Skechers or the Hokas. Nebraska got sped up at the beginning of that game, and they got into, hey, let's just trade threes. And they did it to themselves early, and it became hero ball.
Mornings with Sharp and Handley, weekdays 6 to 10 on 1620 The Zone.
Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Cloudy skies for your Monday. Cool today with a high of 48, northeasterly winds up to 25 miles an hour. 50% chance of showers or an isolated thunder shower here this morning. A bit drier though for your afternoon. Cloudy to mostly cloudy skies overnight. A 30% chance of showers before midnight. Breezy, cool with a low of 36. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV News Watch 7.
What moves you? Whether it's running a race or playing with your grandkids, orthopedic specialists at CHI Health are dedicated to helping you keep life moving. We offer the latest surgical and non-surgical treatments, so you have options for painful shoulders, knees, hips, and every joint in between. Don't let joint pain put life on pause. Count on our team of orthopedic specialists to begin your journey back to what moves you today.
News Talk 1290 COIL is your radio home for Omaha Storm Chasers baseball, proud AAA affiliate of the Kansas City Royals. Tune in to hear every pitch, every hit, and every out as the Chasers play at Warner Park and across the International League in 2024. With the voice of the Omaha Storm Chasers, Nick Batters, on News Talk 1290 COIL.
Tune in to 1290 COIL all season long for your Omaha Storm Chasers baseball as they take on the International League. It's Storm Chasers baseball on 1290 COIL.
Hi, I'm Kamiko, the founder of Miko's Hot Chicken. When we started our family restaurant, we were also raising a family. But let me tell you, it wasn't easy. Our Chase Inc. car was there to reward us on all of our business needs. Now we have a thriving location, and we're hungry for more.
With the Chase Inc. Business Unlimited card, you can earn unlimited 1.5% cash back on every purchase, so your business can go from here to possible. Chase for business. Make more with yours. Real business owners compensated for the participation. Cards issued by JPMorgan Chase Bank and member FDIC. Subject to credit approval. Terms apply.
Hi, Johnny Rogers here, and we are very excited to announce one of Nebraska's favorites, Larry the Cable Guy, will perform at this year's Jet Award April 4th at Baxter Arena. Now, here's the best news. A limited number of arena seats are available for just $39. Just $39 to see the Jet Award and Larry the Cable Guy. Now, that's over the top. Hurry and get your tickets today at BaxterArena.com. Larry the Cable Guy at the 2024 Jet Award event. Hope to see you there.
Email any of our shows anytime into the Equitable Bank inbox. At Equitable, we take banking personally. For me, John at 1620thezone.com. The Equitable Bank inbox from 1620 The Zone.
We're going abroad for the first time in years. To Spain.
But we don't speak Spanish.
So we started using Babbel.
And started learning Spanish fast.
With Babbel, you can start having conversations in another language in just 3 weeks. Babbel's conversational method teaches you real-life words and phrases. And with Babbel's interactive bite-sized lessons, you'll remember what you learned.
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿De dónde eres?
¿De dónde eres?
When you learn a language, you want to actually use it. Babbel is designed with that goal in mind.
In just 3 weeks, we're starting to have conversations in Spanish.
Estoy muy emocionado para ir a España contigo.
Aw, he just said, I'm very excited to go to Spain with you. Nos vamos a divertir mucho.
And that means we're going to have a lot of fun.
Sí. Gracias, Babbel.
Babbel, language for life. Celebrating 10 million subscriptions sold. Now try Babbel for free at Babbel.com. Just go to Babbel.com and start learning a new language today. That's Babbel.com. Babbel.com.
Come to Guardians.
Yeah, I have statistics to back up that we have people that listen.
Mike Schaefer.
Anytime there's sort of a debate as to who can do something, Happer would always put his name forth, for sure.
Husker 24/7 on the Connor Happer Show on 1620, The Zone.
I could be a star.
That's right. It's the return. It's not AI Schaefer. It's real life Mike J. Schaefer of Husker 24/7. He of new fatherhood. Schaefer, good morning, my friend. How are you?
I'm good. I don't know if you could just hear. I just threw out a bag of stinky diapers there. Hudson, you know, just before this interview, had his giant morning dump.
So, nice.
You know, we got that out of the way. Things are good.
Hey, are diaper genies still a thing? Like where you shove all the old diapers into what the tower and then you just throw it away at the end?
Yeah, we don't really do that. We just have like a trash can and just basically get him out as soon as he poops, because the entire room or the upper floor of the house will smell.
Yikes.
So it just seems like it defeats the purpose to have it smell every time you open it, every time you need to use it in that room. So it just makes more sense to just get it out into the garage, which is already cluttered with terrible smells as it is. Plus, we have a dog that you have to pick up after. So it's just like, I don't know. I mean, the garage will never smell good again.
How has fatherhood been for the first couple months here?
Pretty good. I don't know if he likes me or not. I'm not sure when I will find that out. Maybe 18 years from now. But, you know, solid. It's challenging in a lot of ways, rewarding in some other ways. But I am excited to. It's weird, you know, you're like, oh, I have all this time off. I'm going to do all of this. You get nothing accomplished. So warning to anybody that is a future dad for the first time and has any sort of leave whatsoever, you will get nothing done of which you seek to get done. But you do get to spend a lot of time with your kid and interacting with them. And you cherish the adult interactions that you get. So I have never looked forward to doing radio interviews as much as I will this week.
Really? Okay. So I was wondering about that too. Like I kind of thought at the beginning of this, you were going to feel like you were going to be like, yeah, man, maybe this is just something that I could permanently cut out of my life, but you cannot take the radio out of Mike Schaefer, which is great news for all of us.
Just full of hot air and love to hear myself talk. How could you ever take the radio out of Mike Schaefer? No, it's just a lot of it is you just have such limited adult interactions. And my wife also has leave at this time too. And so, yeah, there's two of you here, but like, I know what she's doing every minute of the day now. There's no, you know, like what conversation are we going to have? We just wordlessly put on a movie or a TV show, you know, in the 2 hour window in which he might be sleeping, or the other one of us is just sleeping themselves to try to catch up from this deficit that will never end. So it's a, you know, you like, it's so weird. I never thought this would be a thing, but I like absolutely crave the interaction of other people in a way that I maybe hadn't been COVID.
Well, I'm glad that you have come here to 1620 The Zone of all places for adult interactions.
you know, you want to have people on your same wavelength. I don't need anyone asking me my thoughts on climate change and all of these types of egg brain type conversations that nobody needs my opinion on anyway.
Well, great. We'll ask you about Snickers salad. What are you talking about? What is this?
So you don't know of it either.
No, I don't. I don't. I know of various kinds of salads, but not Snickers.
Well, first of all, there's a whole portion of salad with quotes.
Yes.
That
it's not salad at all.
Right. Yeah. But they're like a cold salad. And I always think of it as like church and potluck or family potluck type food. And now I'm starting to wonder if this is Midwest, but also like specifically Midwest rural. Because I feel like a lot of the people that it's a lot of Omahans that are like, yeah, I've never heard of this. And it's basically a salad that is kind of a whipped cream with marshmallows, so like a fluff, and then it is cool, and you have cut up Snickers, green apples, some people drizzle caramel on top of it. There's some other things that you can add into it, and it's like a really common potluck salad in Columbus, Nebraska, I guess, at any church function or school function or whatever. And I know it's common elsewhere because I know plenty of other people, you know, outside of my hometown that have experienced it as well. But I thought this was just like a well-known Midwestern terrible for you, somehow called salad.
Well, I think one of my problems could be that like whenever I saw the quote unquote salad section in the buffet line, which was like, I mean, none of it is salad. None of it's even green, unless it's like St. Patrick's Day or something like that. It's just dyed that way. I just skipped over it. I never ate it. The Jellos and the Mellos and all of those things. I never ate any of those, mostly because it was very difficult for me to find room on my plate to where I would like just want to waste a spot to take the crappy weird salads.
This feels like a summer segment for you if you need to kill some time or you discuss the proper strategies at a buffet type or a potluck type situation, like what you emphasize, what you don't emphasize. I think people would be interested and have opinions on this. But to what you're saying, yeah, I mean, I think because so much of it was like you would go to these things and there would be like, there's a salad where it's Jell-O, whipped cream, marshmallows, and mandarin oranges.
Yeah.
Like there's a pistachio salad. I think people like know what these are, but yeah, if you never like bothered to eat any of them, or if you don't have room on your plate, you just skip by them. I guess there's like a whole world of completely unhealthy salads out there that the Schaefer family certainly had on things like Easter, you know, growing up, and then definitely was like part of the United Methodist Church potluck team as well.
I cannot wait until like, the other areas of the country find out that this has existed for years, much like they've found out of it. Like, oh, let's all go to like Jackson Hole and live there now. That's going to be the case with Midwest salads that aren't salads. Like California is going to figure out this exists one day and they're going to love the idea.
Yeah. There's that Twitter account that like, I don't ever follow, but when it's good, like it gets tweeted into your timeline. So you get sort of the best of the best. It's like the Midwest versus everybody.
Oh yeah.
They definitely once a year around springtime will have like a picture of this array of like cold salads that are like that pistachio one that I told you about, Snickers salad. And then it'll be like a shot of a, you know, Northeastern person just like looking completely bamboozled by the whole thing.
All right, Schaefer. Do you have thoughts on NCAA tournament officiating or things of that nature?
I think that it is really, really difficult to have any consistency from game to game, team to team. Like, I mean, we watched the game using Creighton as example. Oregon shot one free throw in 40 minutes of regulation. Doug Eady shot, 22 free throws against Tennessee himself, like 18, something somewhere in that,
yeah,
in that range. Like, it's impossible to know how anything's going to be officiated. I think everything is largely reputation-based at this point. But you could see that Illinois wasn't going to beat UConn when they couldn't get to the free throw line by just running into people as they did for 9 straight games in March, where they worked up, a free throw differential that got into the hundreds by the end of it. I mean, they had 20 plus free throw differential in just the Big Ten tournament alone. Teams go about it different ways. Like Iowa State plays really aggressive defense because they're going to force you to try to call it. It's no different than like how some secondaries operate in football, where it's like, we're going to hold you and we're going to see if they're going to call it.
Mm-hmm.
And it just makes things really hard when you get into this tournament setting and you have officials that have never called a team before. And they're probably just going to go off of reputation. Here's the thing about Edie. I thought a lot of those were fouls.
Me too.
There were other ones that weren't. that they didn't call, because you just can't quite frankly call everything.
They're literally grabbing him the entire game.
Yeah, and he's such a unique player. And I think that's just how Tennessee plays, right? Like, I think they're a very handsy team. He's such a unique player that he's just going to do that. Terrence Shannon, same thing. Like, if officials are going to let him lower the shoulder and just run into people all game, he's going to spend a lot of time at the free throw line. So it's really hard, I think, to find this balance in how officiating should work in college basketball. And I guess what's going to be really interesting with this Final Four, which, you know, despite the tournament being kind of blah, I think we got an okay Final Four. That one region, the Alabama Clemson, like, I didn't care about any of that.
Yep.
But assuming UConn wins against Alabama, whoever they get of NC State, Purdue is a compelling game. So I think, you know, I was at risk of just completely checking out here. And instead, I'm very much hoping we get Purdue UConn. That is the matchup that I want. I think that would be a really entertaining game. And quite frankly, I don't know who I think would win in that scenario either.
I hope we get Purdue UConn as well, only so the conglomeration of the Big East and Big Ten fans around here can just yell about and make it a narrative on who's the better conference based solely upon the winner of that game. It'll be fun that way.
Yeah, I don't know. That feels like one of those conversations I'm more than happy to ignore. Is there a more popular college athlete right now than DJ Burns in the basketball scene?
No, he's done awesome. He's cashed in on everything too. He's like, he's very much enjoying the moment. He's talking smack to everybody he sees. He's on every radio show and podcast you could ever imagine. And he doesn't seem to be that afraid of the idea of, like, he's only this fun of a player because he's giant, like, which I love. He's very self-aware in that way.
What's fun about college basketball relative to the NBA, where the skill level is so much better and the style is so different, is that this DJ Burns Edie matchup is you can't get this. Like, you're not getting this in the NBA. Like, you're two guys who look absolutely nothing like you would build a center. And because one, it doesn't seem possible with his overall size, and the other doesn't seem possible because you just don't think he can hold up. And yet, these are two of the most compelling players in the month of March right now. I mean, UConn has a great center of their own too, but it's just like this matchup, I think people are really excited for it. And then they're also really worried, like, if someone gets in foul trouble right away, it's going to ruin the whole game.
By the way, you mentioned that the tournament was sort of blah. We did end up getting a lot of chalk, I guess, through the first weekend. Like, how did you, with the changes in your life, how did you take in the tournament this year compared to others?
I was able to watch, you know, a fair amount. Like, obviously, without having much to do, I watched a lot of conference basketball tournaments, which was great. I even, you know, NC State, watching them against North Carolina, is like, why were they not good earlier in the year? That's like basically how I felt. Like, they have pieces, and it goes beyond DJ Burns. Like, DJ Horn's really good. They have that three-point specialist that's solid. They have a defensive stopper on their team. Like,
yeah,
the
guy who just punches everybody. I like that guy, the big, tall, white guy. And we saw that up close in Pittsburgh last weekend, and I'm like, yep, they have the enforcer. They have checked that box.
So, like, I went into it watching a lot of basketball, and then the games just, like, weren't, you know, Creighton, Oregon was probably one of the best games that I watched all tournament. It was just compelling for a variety of reasons, and then the actual game was pretty good. You had games that, like, finished with interesting, you had down to the wire, but the actual gameplay was terrible. Like, Florida Atlantic and whoever they lost to, the 8 seed that they lost, or 9 seed, Northwestern. That was a horrible, horrible game of basketball.
Yep.
And, yeah, it finished with, like, Johnny Davis or John L. Davis, like, holding the ball for 7 seconds and then launching like a 33-foot three-pointer at the end of regulation that gets blocked because they just didn't run a play or whatever it was. You know, that's Michigan's coach now. So we'll see how that goes for them. But it just, like, the quality wasn't particularly good. And then it didn't feel like there was a lot that was interesting, throughout. And then the Sweet 16, Elite Eight, and none of the games were that close either. It really came down to the wire. Like, your best teams kind of separated and your hot teams separated as well.
Yeah. I don't know about you. I was talking about UConn a little bit before. I I don't know what it is about them. They obviously are like a heel, like they're happy to embrace the heel, but I am like, even in their first game when they were up by 50 points on Wagner or whoever they're playing, like I will watch them bludgeon somebody to death. Like I think they're so much fun because they have that kind of edge to them all the time. They don't play like they've been anointed as the best team in the country. I would be super curious to see how that would match up against a team that could actually match them come from like a personnel standpoint in Purdue in the final. But like I've had a lot of UConn love over the last couple of weeks here. Maybe that's just my conference cheering self getting into it. But like I really enjoy watching them play, and I can't really think of a national champion or potential national champion. I've been like, yes, I really want them. I kind of want them to win.
Yeah, they're good, I think, overall, because it provides its own element of, okay, can anybody beat these guys? And like, if they actually run through this and they never play another close game this year either, and they win back-to-back titles, I mean, we don't have to throw the word dynasty in there, but you could call it probably the best 2-year stretch, you know, certainly with the titles, it makes that obvious, but like the way they've done it, like I can't think of, and we've watched some really great college basketball teams over the years, they eventually have that game that tests them. But in this setting for 2 straight years, nobody's even close. And like Illinois was playing pretty good basketball up until they faced UConn, and they didn't belong in the gym. Like it was like evident very early that they did not belong in that game. And so what will make it fun is if either Purdue or NC State can actually put pressure. And I'm just assuming UConn's beating Alabama.
Like, me too.
I don't really, you know, apologies to the lifelong Alabama basketball fans out there and Nate Oates and whatever, but I'm not interested in them. The Alabama Clemson game, I didn't want to watch at all. Like I had no interest in that region as soon as it broke the way that it did. And I don't see how they're going to stay on the court against UConn. So to me, it really comes down to, could we get the two teams that people universally thought they were the best two for most of the year, with Houston being the other one, and UConn and Purdue, and then you have this force in Edie versus this kind of unstoppable runaway team right now in UConn, and then how does that match up, and what does that look like? And I really want that, because I think we don't get a lot of compelling. Like last year wasn't compelling. Like you had San Diego State and UConn.
Yep.
Do you remember any moment from that game that wasn't like the very end when, you know, one shining moment plays?
No, but I do love that part.
Yeah, well, I know you love that part, but it's just like, other than the Final Four where, you know, Florida Atlantic and San Diego State played for the right to lose to UConn in an unbelievable finish, like there was nothing in that championship game. I feel like at least with NC State or Purdue, we can talk ourselves into it being interesting. Now UConn can remove that from the equation really quickly.
Hey Schaaf, I don't know if you've had any takes that are out there in the last couple of weeks, but since you've been gone, Nebraska lost an athletic director quite dramatically and then gained a new one. Any Husker thoughts before we let you go here? Or Dylan Raiola throwing in practice. You could also add that to the equation if you want to.
I don't have any Raiola thoughts at this time. And really, my only like athletic department thoughts, I don't have anything on Troy Dannon. I didn't know who he was. I'll be entirely honest. I immediately looked him up when I saw that this is how it went. And you learn things about him. And he seems like he could be a pretty strong fit. And if you notice, the football teams of which he's been the athletic director for the last couple of years have had some pretty big seasons. So that in itself seems like it could be good, but you don't know what his overall effect with that would be. I'm more struck by this, Connor. He is inheriting a far more stable athletic department than any of his previous predecessors did. Like Trev Alberts didn't have this. Bill Moose didn't have this. Sean Eichhorst didn't have this. Tom Osborne didn't have this. Like it is very stable when you think of the personalities and the people that are involved at the head coaching positions, where, you know, we don't know exactly what's going to happen with Matt Rhule and Nebraska football, but you assume if it goes well, he's in this for the long haul. But everything else, I mean, Will Bolt has things running. Amy Williams has things running. Fred Hoiberg has things running. Mark Manning and the wrestling program are doing great. John Cook, and they obviously, you know, we forget Nebraska played for a national championship in December because for once the winter was so good.
like basketball just was able to take over. It was a natural transition. The next big decision beyond the stadium that Troy Dannon faces is when John Cook decides to step away.
Yep.
And it may not even be his decision to make. And so it's just kind of like it is like a turnkey. He inherited an athletic department that is not a dumpster fire. And that's kind of
it's new
in the cap of Trev Albert.
Yeah.
He left this place so much better than he found it.
I agree completely on that. Good single take, Schaefer. You should write something about that today.
Maybe. I feel like the moment passed.
All right, Schaefer, happy for you guys. Say hello to tiny baby Hudson for me. And we look forward to talking to you on a weekly occasion from now on.
Yeah, it'll be great. It'll be great. Looking forward to it. We'll have much to discuss. I'm happy to be back in the mix, and I'm happy to talk to other fellow adults.
Bye, Schaefer.
Yep.
Mike Schaefer, Husker 24/7. He of new fatherhood. Sounds like every other new father I've ever met. Yep. Just in the minutes that I try to, that I'm not thinking about the child, I try to sleep or do anything else that isn't having anything to do with the child. Sounds about perfect to me. Good stuff from Mike Schaefer. Schaefer, happy to have him back in the fold. All right, quick timeout. Peter's got the odd news on the other side on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone. But first, the sports calendar is loaded up, and FanDuel's making it even more exciting to get in on the action. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets with any winning $5 bet. That's right, $200 you could use to bet the tourney, Major League Baseball, NBA, NHL, so much more. I mean, look, we have the tournament games coming up for this weekend. NC State and Purdue, 9.5 there for Purdue. UConn, 11.5 point favorites over Alabama. Maybe you're interested in a dog in one of those. Major League Baseball, we talked about the Nerfies all weekend. College football season over-unders. Basketball playoffs are getting close. Even, how about this, in the women's game tonight? May I interest you in LSU +1.5 against the Iowa Hawkeyes? +1.5. All that is available for you on the FanDuel Sportsbook. Head over to FanDuel.com/Happer and make your first bet a win. Once again, $200 in bonus bets with any winning $5 bet. FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. 21 and over, present in Iowa. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is now withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
For the Jays, the Huskers, and even you Jayskers, we are 1620 The Zone.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that we can give our daughters everything they need to grow and learn, but not every child can focus on classes and play dates.
Nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. face hunger. That's 1 in 6. School lunch might be their only meal each day, and it's heartbreaking to imagine any child going to bed hungry. We're dreaming of a perfect day when kids can smile, play, and just be kids without worrying about where their next meal will come from. Feeding America is working to make that perfect day a reality.
Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste. That food is given to families and children in need. Being a kid should be about doing things that make an ordinary day extraordinary. Learning to play an instrument, building a sandcastle, hosting tea parties. Hunger should never be an obstacle to growing up.
You can help end childhood hunger in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. 120,000 miles of night drives, daily commutes, and who knows how many.
Are we there yet?
Through countless fixes, elbow grease, and a new radiator, you kept your ride alive. With eBay Motors, you have over 122 million parts to keep it running. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, they'll be the perfect fit every time. Plus, at these prices, well, we're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
Adopt US Kids presents What to Expect When You're Expecting a Teenager. Learning the Lingo.
Today I'm going to help parents translate teen slang. Now, when a teen says something is on fleek, it's exactly like saying, that's rad. It simply means that something is awesome or cool. Another one is totes. It's exactly like saying, totally, just shorter. As in, I totes love going to the mall with Becca. Another word you might hear is jelly. Jelly is a shorter, better way to say jealous, as in, Chloe, I am like so jelly of your unicorn phone case.
You don't have to speak teen to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will think you're, rad, just the same. To learn more, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUSKids, and the Ad Council.
You can do it all by yourself. Whoa, baby girl, what's your name? Let me talk to you, let me buy you a drink. Whoa.
Spilled your drink? Quick, the quicker picker-upper. Bounty picks up spills quicker, and each sheet is 2 times more absorbent, so you can use less than the leading ordinary brand. So, you can get back to your night. Bounty, the quicker picker-upper.
We are the NFHS. That stands for the National Federation of State High School Associations. But really, what we stand for, together with the NSAA, are the 78,000 high school sports and performing arts students in Nebraska. And so we stand. We stand for the runners, debate team members, and basketball players. We stand for their coaches, officials, and adjudicators. We stand for the drummers, football players, and actors. We stand for the golfers, singers, and swimmers. We stand as the national leader and advocate for these essential activities and all who participate in them and make them possible. Because it is our purpose to ensure that high school students get to play, perform, and compete together. To learn more about who we are and what we stand for, visit nfhs.org.
I feel good.
Dad, are you singing to your cereal?
Yes, I am, like I knew that I would.
No, a dance too?
Come on, Ava. Silk almond milk starts the morning on a high note.
Yow! Songs, dances, and dad jokes.
So good. So good. I got you.
Silk almond milk.
With calcium, vitamins A, D, and E.
Feel plenty good.
Don't miss this week's Zone Deal.
This week's deal is to Mexatilly Restaurant in downtown Omaha at 16th and Harney. Get $50 in gift certificates for only $25 to Mexatilly Restaurant. Mexatilly Restaurant offers authentic Mexican cuisine with the traditional flavors of your favorite Mexican dishes with an innovative touch. Mexatilly Restaurant in downtown Omaha. This week's half-off deal.
Zone Deals go fast. 9 a.m. Friday, 1620thezone.com. Tickets for Less. Best seats, best prices, no service fees. Shop ticketsforless.com. KOZN Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
All right, before we get to the odd news, I'd like to say this. This is a yearly reminder. April Fool's Day, not fun for people who like to pay attention to news and news items. I've seen some people biting at various different things today. If you have an announcement about your company today or about maybe your status in the transfer portal or where you're committing to or, you know, things like that, maybe just hold it until tomorrow. Because nobody's going to take it seriously if it's today. Like, do I really think that Aurora football is going to play a home and home with Alaska Barrow High School? I don't, but I don't know for sure.
But who's to say?
I think it's an April Fool's joke, but who's to know? And I guess that's the point.
And I'm sure Josh is disappointed he wasn't here to do the odd news on April Fool's Day.
I'm sure he is. I'm sure he's very disappointed to not be here in general. Very disappointed.
And I already dropped the ball by forgetting to play the bumper when he came back. But here it is.
Oh, wow. Let's go.
It's here.
And now we've reached the point in the show where Josh Hodson reads the peculiar,
Peterman,
the bizarre, the comical, the odd news with Odd Son. Odd news, Odd Son. See what we did there? The odd news with Oddson
All right, Peter, man, what do we have today?
I will admit, I think that this is an interesting one to start with. There's been a lot of, I guess I shouldn't say a lot of, because I haven't heard it from a ton of people, but I've talked to some people who are very excited about next week's solar eclipse.
Oh, when is this, by the way?
Next Monday, April 8th.
Okay, so I think I did the math on this a couple weeks ago, but it was so long ago. I won't be here next Monday. I believe I'll be on the plane during the eclipse.
Okay, that's cool.
Is that bad, though? I feel like that's not
is
good.
Is this bad for air traffic?
I mean, like, I feel like bad things
sudden
could happen.
Darkness in the sky.
If there's ever an unsteadiness in the atmosphere as far as where the sun is and how much light there, I don't think I want to be up in the air, but I don't know. I guess we're going to find out on Monday.
I didn't realize the magnitude of this eclipse until Andy Popo told me he was traveling to Arkansas to have a prime viewing of it.
Yeah. And where's the path of totality this year?
It's going to be, I think, from Texas through a lot of the Southeast.
Okay. Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. Thank you, NASA, for giving me this. Yeah, straight through the heart of Texas, through northern Arkansas, southern Missouri, Illinois, Indiana, like straight over Ohio, upstate New York's going to catch a little bit of it, Maine.
I think Omaha and Lincoln should have a pretty heavy...
Yeah, we're not that far off.
Not too bad.
We're not that far off. But I'm excited to see how this goes while I'm in the sky.
But I use this solar eclipse. Yes. That is going to be a very cool point of view. If it's trippy, you'll have to take some photos and see and send them and see how it looks.
We'll see.
One of these odd news stories was mentioning that the solar eclipse shouldn't overshadow this other rare event that we're soon going to have, cicadas emerging. And not just cicadas emerging, because they do emerge every 13 to 17 years. Two of the biggest, what they call broods of cicadas, will emerge together this spring once the ground warms up enough, which is happening sooner than usual, experts are saying. First time this is going to happen since 1803.
Whoa.
Thomas Jefferson was
writing
about it.
It's going to be really loud.
It's going to be real loud, especially and they say Georgia and Illinois are going to get the brunt of this.
Yikes.
So to the Georgians and the Illinoisans, be ready, because it might get very, very loud.
Sorry. The 2024 periodical cicada emergence, brood 19, is what they're calling it, which will co-emerge with 17-year brood 17 or brood 13. These two broods are adjacent in North Central Illinois is going to get rough.
Yeah.
So
it's going to get loud.
Wow.
And this cicada expert, referring to it as cicadageddon,
this is not good.
Said that he sometimes, when he's in the thick of this, when these big emergencies happen, he has to wear like protective earwear.
Yikes.
Because it does get that loud.
Okay.
So
I don't want to go too deep into this, but isn't there some like biblical symbolism with cicadas? And
I think there is something.
I don't want to dive too far into it, but yeah, that's probably not
good. This is the part that really boggled my mind. The numbers that will come out this year, averaging around 1 million per acre over hundreds of millions of acres across 16 states, easily hundreds of trillions, maybe quadrillions of cicadas.
It does not sound fun.
I agree. It sounds...
Maybe I'll travel to a different country during this time.
Maybe it's time to fly elsewhere for the springtime.
All right.
So, yeah, cicada again is coming, in addition to our ever so rare solar eclipse. A shoplifter chased by horse police.
Horse police.
And this may not sound like much, but... this happened a little over a week ago, and down in New Mexico, this guy stole about $230 worth of merch from a Walgreens. And you know, that happens.
That's a pretty big haul at Walgreens.
that happens at Walgreens. And I don't know. It's not totally clear from what I read why the horse police were on site at the time, but maybe it was just right place, right time. This guy came sprinting out of the Walgreens and immediately got chased by multiple police on horseback.
Yikes.
To the point where he ran into the road, and they just released the body cam footage. That's why I mentioned it. The body cam footage just came out today. And if you have a chance, check it out, because it is rather hilarious to watch this person run out of Walgreens with $200 worth of stolen items into the road. What do you
get, like just a bunch of Sour Patch Kids? I have no idea. Every time I go to Walgreens, every time I'm ever in Walgreens, it's just to get copious amounts of candy.
Yeah, it's candy and, pretty much and drinks. That's about it. But
maybe like some lip balm.
There's a sound bite where he turns around as the horse is chasing him and goes, "It wasn't me."
The horse just doesn't understand.
The
you,
horse
man.
Doesn't care what you think. He's gonna chase you when you're running out of Walgreens.
Yep.
So that, I thought that was pretty funny.
That is good.
Not,
I like that.
Not something you see every day. And then it is, of course, it's April Fool's Day, and we had to find something that was April Fool's related. I didn't know this. Google, in their infancy, when they were not nearly as big as they were today, they liked to put out fake information, like news bits, every April Fool's Day that they were doing something new, something revolutionary that they would totally make up. Some examples, they said that they were opening a research center on the moon. Another year, they said they were going to roll out Scratch and Sniff on its search engine. So they just like to do silly things. But I guess Gmail, almost everyone uses it now.
Yes.
Was.
Except for me, Yahoo.
Oh, yeah. I do like Yahoo as well. They initially passed off Gmail as a joke. They announced the first version of it on April Fool's Day, and AP posted about it, and everyone started calling in and saying, "Oh, they got you guys. This is what they do. They post fake stuff, and they got you." And then Google saw that they were duped and gave them a call, and they're like, "This is actually, we're passing this off as fake because we don't know. It's very new. But I think this is going to be real." So they called the reporter down.
Oh, so they were trying to
gave them the early end to look at and experience the absolute first version of Gmail, which seems like an odd way to start your new revolutionary email system.
But yeah.
They thought it would be a nice, funny little bit to make the general public think it was a joke. But here we are.
Well, sometimes you got to test it out, see what the people's reaction to
it. Yeah, and honestly, not a bad idea, because if it blew up, you could just say, "Oh, this was never going to be a thing. It was April Fool's Day."
By the way, believe us. From YouTube, I'm thinking of locusts. Thank you, Why Not Hoiberg. Locusts, not cicadas in the Bible. Although Charles does say 1620, the Bible prophecies.
Yes.
Very good. I have one odd thing for you. So, by the way, I don't know what this guy's name is, but I really had a great time watching his videos yesterday on TikTok when I was doing nothing. There is a guy who is on TikTok, and he is the owner of a cow, a full-size cow. And I think he like just has it kind of domesticated. It's like his pet. And so he does this bit where he makes himself a nice dinner, and he sits down at the dinner table, and he attempts to eat dinner with the cow around him. But you know what happens with the cow? The cow just eats everything.
Oh, this is great.
It's really funny.
I haven't heard
great
of this.
Videos. I'm going to start tweeting them out. I think they're very fun. Cow just eats the pancakes.
Does he even use
cow
it for
eats
like
the spaghetti? Cow eats the bread.
Or just
I don't know
eats
what he does
with
the
it.
Cow. He's.
I think it would be infinitely more funny. He's if getting it was just 30.
He's generally. Getting millions of views with it on TikTok, so he's good for that as well.
He just eats it all.
All right, thanks, Peter.
That's good.
That's good stuff. Is the odd news. We'll come back with the noon hour. Still a couple more Creighton things that we can discuss. Also, all of the happenings in the women's tournament, as it's reaching its near end. We have a couple good games tonight on the women's side. Also, text messages from regarding Trev Alberts. I do have a question regarding it, and it's not serious in nature at all. Next on 1620 The Zone.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio, this is 1620 The Zone.
For forget the drive to Colorado or Missouri. Stop into any Omaha 42 Degrees and indulge in a curated cannabis experience. Premium flower, cannabis, pre-rolls, and cannabis accessories paired with an elevated customer service experience. All are waiting for you at 42 Degrees. From novices to connoisseurs, we're here to elevate your cannabis journey. 42 Degrees, your destination for top-tier cannabis, second to none product selection, and exceptional service. Buy your mom's house.
There is only one constant in the universe, and that's change.
Brent Rasmussen of Mortgage Specialists.
I'm sure many of you remember the incredibly low interest rates that were available only a few years ago. Well, things changed. Now rates are higher. But would you believe me if I told you there was a time when people were paying double-digit rates? And that's the thing. Everything changes. Rates go up. Rates go down. So if you're waiting for the perfect time when rates drop before you buy a home, you might miss out on the home you really want. So when you think about it, what's a thing today might not be a thing tomorrow. See? Change is good. I'm Brent Rasmussen. Call me at Mortgage Specialists, and we can show you all the details. Mortgage Specialists. Driven. Trusted. Reliable.
Click mtg-specialists.com. NMLS number 5918, Equal Housing Lender.
When it comes to protecting your home, Jay Stennett Contracting takes pride in ensuring every detail is handled. Roofing, siding, gutters. When it comes to the exterior of your home, Jay Stennett Contracting has you covered. Have you noticed stains on your ceiling this winter? With storm season around the corner and the damage it can bring, let Jay Stennett Contracting ensure that your roof is durable and holds up against the weather this spring and summer. When you need an honest assessment, Jay Stennett Contracting has you covered. JSCRestoration.com.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. 120,000 miles of night drives, daily commutes, and who knows how many.
Are we there yet?
Through countless fixes, elbow grease, and a new radiator, you kept your ride alive. With eBay Motors, you have over 122 million parts to keep it running. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, they'll be the perfect fit every time. Plus, at these prices, well, we're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
Small business owners, we know finishing your to-do list can feel like climbing a mountain, but that mountain is also covered in banana peels. Then, when something new gets added to your list, you're like, nope, I'm already climbing this huge, super slippery banana peel mountain of a to-do list. At Progressive, we don't want to make your day any harder. That's why we make it easy to manage your policy on our mobile app. So climbing that banana peel mountain feels more like a leisurely stroll. See if you can save on commercial auto insurance in as little as 6 minutes at ProgressiveCommercial.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Coverage subject to policy terms and conditions.
Got the happy hour blues? Get to Cops for happy hour relief with two happy hours from 3 to 6 p.m. and 8:30 p.m. till close Sunday through Friday. Cops serves 24-ounce domestic drafts for just $3 and 24-ounce craft drafts for only $4, plus $2 off appetizers. The restaurant that offers great pizza, burgers, and tasty charred wings now offers two great happy hours. Visit Cops today at 180th and Center, the Shadow Lake Town Center, and 72nd and Jones, or click CopsPizza.com. Cops, pizza, and so much more.
Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. EquitableOnline.com.
College basketball's biggest tournament is coming, and it's time to start betting like a pro with the world's largest sports book right at your fingertips. Circa Sports Iowa. It's sports betting the way it should be. High betting limits, tight money line splits, exceptional customer service, and more. Fund and bet like a pro anywhere, anytime. It's never been easier. Download your new bookie before all of the March action at circasports.com. If you or someone you know may have a problem with gambling, call 1-800-238-7777.
All right, welcome back. We're the Connor Happer Show. You're on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. Connor Happer, Peter Krenzer with you here on a Wednesday. Coming up, we'll hear from Sam McEwen at the top of the 1 o'clock hour. Still want to discuss a couple of the things that are going on in the women's tournament tonight. We'll do that here in just a few minutes as well. Hot Danger Wonders, by the way, on YouTube. Technically, Kalkbrenner, Ashworth, and Alexander all have eligibility left, right? Yes. Technically, That is true. Technically, that is true. We'll see which one, if any. I don't know. We haven't heard anything on Ashworth. He didn't walk on senior day, you know. Kind of makes me think that we'll see him back. It might depend on the things that happen around him. And then, you know, the sense that I've gotten from Trey for the entire year is this is his last run through. Kalkbrenner as well. But they'll test the NBA waters. We'll see what they get back from him. We'll talk about Creighton in the future a little bit more later on in the show. But this came out on, gosh, what was this? Friday night? Once again, Peter, date and times are really hard for me. Yes, Friday evening.
Yeah, yeah, Friday.
This was a Friday news dump. So KETV FOIA'd some text messages from some people regarding the Trev Alberts situation at Nebraska. And I want to read them to you with assistance, of course, from our friends from KETV. But I also want to ask a very important question at the end. So stick with me here real quick. When there began to the night before the announcement, so this is March 12th, a few weeks ago. It feels like a long time ago as Trev Alberts is gearing up to leave for Texas A&M. One of the regents, Robert Schaefer, texted Trev. He said, "Let me know if you want to visit tonight, yet tonight. Regardless, please give me a call before finalizing any decision. We are going to make this work." Then another one of the regents, Tim Clare, messaged Trev on that evening. It's very difficult, by the way, to read these in like text form as well, because some of it has bad grammar and interesting punctuation and things like that. It's you know, some old guy texts. By the way, on Tim Clare, he has Trev's number saved in his phone as Trev and Angie. Wasn't a group chat. Just it's like when old people like have one connected Facebook, you know.
It's just
an old guy move.
One entity on one phone.
Just an old guy move. He said to Trev, "I haven't heard from you, and I don't know if that's a good thing or not. What I do know is that we're going to have a great president soon, and I hope you would give him a chance. The other thing I know is that if NU was a stock, I'd buy it. Exciting times are on the horizon for us, and you're a huge part of the vision. Don't let a couple situations that happened either when Ted was leaving or already gone be a driver in the decision. Instead, be a part of something bigger than you. And with your big heart, your love, you, our love of Nebraska and you, what the N means and what your heart feels about Nebraska, you know what the right call is for you and your family, .. And if your heart needs help convincing you your mind, let me know and I will do all I can do to help your heart, winky face." And then he followed up at 4:31 in the morning after rereading the text and did, you know, star, like I misspelled this word, your.
Something realized at 4:30 in the morning.
I don't know when the
winky face really.
The initial text went really through at 9:10 on Tuesday night, and that one came through at the correction came through at 4:30 in the morning on Wednesday.
Woke up in the middle of the night, hot sweats. I made a grammatical error.
Reread these things again. The next morning, Claire said, "I'd just like you to consider that we changed our structure so that you report directly to the president. We approved every project you brought before us. We have a void at president, but that will be filled soon. Give us a chance. Please call. If you stay at NU, I will pledge to work." This is as the news is kind of breaking, right? Like we found out about this. And this is during the day on Wednesday, the 12th or 13th, whatever day it was. "If you stay at NU, I pledge to work with you and our new president to provide you with what you're looking for from a structural / operational / leadership standpoint." And then Wednesday night, after the news had kind of already broken, gone through, "Hey, Trev, just so you know, as news has broke, Nebraskans are devastated. If you leave, you represent commitment, grit, and determination. Leadership Nebraska is and loves about you. That was a nonsensical text message from our governor, Jim Pillen. Punctuation was lacking in that category. Another follow-up from Jim Pillen. Hey, Trev, just so you know, I simply respect you. A space D and your decision. Hope you understand that I tried. Selfishly to do everything I space K we do to try and fix things. And then it kind of cuts off there. Once again, stay tuned because I do have a question about this here in just a second. And that is what we have in the Nebraska really wants to keep Trev Alberts. By the way, Hot Danger says Helping Your Heart is the name of my new country album, which is, I think it's actually pretty good.
It is good.
Jeff says Tex have very cringy teenage boyfriend vibes. So there was quite the panic that ensued there. I would like to ask you this question, and there's nothing, there's, you know, from KTV's standpoint, like, it's funny. Maybe there would be something interesting in there. But my question is, why? Why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? We need to Hulk it over it. He's gone. There's a new athletic director. They tried. It does a really good job, obviously, of illustrating the point, which was Nebraska was caught off guard by this. The leadership that was in place was caught off guard by this. And
which was already very well known.
Already very well known. And that they were disappointed in his decision and they would have, you know, bent over backwards to keep him. And, you know, clearly, you know, Trev had his mind made up. Like, maybe from the perspective of, you know, what does Trev, you know, what was the reasoning behind him leaving? What does he want? Like, what drove him to leave in the first place? You know, I think it was a lot more simple than he just liked Texas A&M in that regard. But once again, I'll ask the question, what are we doing? That was my reaction to this when I saw it on Friday night. It is not any different now. That's all. What are we doing here?
What are we doing?
What are we doing here? We get a tweet from Mustache Adam. These texts reek of desperate, just dumped boyfriend material. Woof. Jack John has an answer to my question. No longer Jack John Bracketology, by the way. Interesting that he is retired following Creighton and Nebraska's exits from the tournament. He tweets in the JTech Construction Zone Twitter feed, the reason we have to do this is because we need to hate Trev. We need more. I think it's time to stop hating Trev. That's right. I said it. It was probably time to stop hating Trev a long time ago. It was surprising that he left. I still don't fully understand the reasons why. He jumped ship. He went on to what he considered to be greener pastures. He didn't finish the job here. All of that stings a little bit. It's been 3 weeks. I'm over it. It's time to get over it. Nebraska has a new athletic director
who has been introduced. Yep. New.
And they're going to be fine.
President.
They are going to be fine without him. I think it's a loss for Nebraska. I think he was a really good visionary athletic director that would fight for Nebraska. That would, that was entrenched in the conversations surrounding the people that he need to be entrenched with, such as the Big Ten, the people on campus, the people, the money in the area. Like, I think that was what he was really good at. And also saying at the same time, hey, this is what Nebraska wants, and this is what would be good for Nebraska. He fought for it, right? Can Nebraska find that in another person, or can they find it in a different way? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I'm over it.
Think that one day maybe we'll get from Trev himself all the concrete reasons?
No. I mean, first of all, it doesn't, like, we were doing the whole, he was doing the tweets thing and everybody was getting after him on Twitter. Like, it didn't do him any good to like engage with it at the moment. Maybe no. Someday. I mean, down the line, but like, I don't know. Like, we do this thing right away where it's like, oh, take his name off the stadium and I hate him and Trader Trev and Benedict Alberts and all this stuff. But like, it's, I don't know how long it takes for you guys to get over things. It's been 3 weeks for me. I don't really feel that way anymore. I never probably did as much as you all did. But if you give it 3 or 4 years down the line, hell, even 10 or whatever, and he wanted to come back. Cause I think what will endure is his vision, which will be carried out in a different way by Troy Dana. Now that was a good thing. That was a good vision. I saw people who were at the time were like, you know, questioning whether Trev was ever a good athletic director in the first place. And I'm like, what are you guys talking about? We love this guy, you know? And so just because obviously the way he left affects his legacy, and it'll be different now. It'll always be different now, just like it would have, just like it was, you know, compared to how we thought it was going to be with Scott Frost at first. But like, if he comes back, if Scott Frost walks back on Nebraska's campus right now, it's not like they're going to shun him and throw stuff at him. No. Like, it's done. It happened. It's the same thing with Trev. If you see him, don't throw anything at him, please. That's all.
Don't do that.
All right. We'll look ahead here. Well, we'll look ahead a little bit on the women's tournament. We'll also look back. What's going on? Why is the women's tournament known more for snafus than it was for Caitlin Clark and for LSU and for South Carolina, who's going about their business very calmly and swiftly at this point? So we'll take a look back and hit the big marks from the kind of train wreck of an NCAA women's basketball tournament next on 1620 The Zone.
Previously on The Crossover.
I have mostly sports things that I want nothing to do with muted.
Okay.
Major League Baseball, muted. Baseball, muted.
I thought you loved the Mets.
I did. Yeah. Mahomes, Chiefs, Harbaugh, Wolverines, Michigan, FIFA World Cup.
Goal.
Qatar.
Goal.
World Cup. VAR, USMTNC, World Cup, Wordle. I got lots on here.
Mornings with Sharp and Hanley, The Connor Happer Show, Unsportsmanlike Conduct, 6A to 6P, 1620, The Zone. Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620, The Zone.
Cloudy with mist and drizzle and cool here for the rest of your Monday with a high today in Omaha of 48 degrees and east northeasterly winds up to 25 miles an hour. Another chance for showers here tonight. Cloudy to mostly cloudy skies, breezy again, cool with a low of 36. Cloudy Tuesday morning becoming bright for Tuesday afternoon, windy, still pretty cool with a high of 56. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV News Watch 7.
It's easy to see the common signs of transmission trouble.
If your engine revs before it falls into gear.
If it seems to switch gears for no reason.
So watch for the signs.
Certified transmission. The job done right at the right price.
Hi, I'm Kamiko, the founder of Miko's Hot Chicken. When we started our family restaurant, we were also raising a family. But let me tell you, it wasn't easy. Our Chase Inc. car was there to reward us on all of our business needs. Now we have a thriving location, and we're hungry for more.
With the Chase Inc. Business Unlimited card, you can earn unlimited 1.5% cash back on every purchase, so your business can go from here to possible. Chase for business. Make more with yours. Real business owners compensated for their participation. Cards issued by JPMorgan Chase Bank, and member FDIC, subject to credit approval. Terms apply.
Hey, baseball fans, join the Blur tailgate at Hilton Omaha this June for our 12th annual hospitality event during the College Baseball Championship Series. Book an experience for your clients or employees with an inclusive bar, buffet, TVs, music, and tailgate games. Secure your spot today and let Blur Events take care of all the work so you can enjoy the day. Plus, we're just steps away from Charles Schwab Field. Visit blurevents.com to book your group, buy tickets, or learn about sponsorships. That's blurevents.com, your college baseball and football tailgate destination.
Hi, Johnny Rogers here, and we are very excited to announce one of Nebraska's favorites, Larry the Cable Guy, will perform at this year's Jet Award April 4th at Baxter Arena. Now, here's the best news. A limited number of arena seats are available for just $39. Just $39 to see the Jet Award and Larry the Cable Guy. Now, that's over the top. Hurry and get your tickets today at BaxterArena.com. Larry the Cable Guy at the 2024 Jet Award event. Hope to see you there.
We're going abroad for the first time in years. To Spain.
But we don't speak Spanish.
So we started using Babbel.
And started learning Spanish fast.
With Babbel, you can start having conversations in another language in just 3 weeks. Babbel's conversational method teaches you real-life words and phrases. And with Babbel's interactive bite-sized lessons, you'll remember what you learned.
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿De dónde eres?
¿De dónde eres?
When you learn a language, you want to actually use it. Babbel is designed with that goal in mind.
In just 3 weeks, we're starting to have conversations in Spanish.
Estoy muy emocionado para ir a España contigo.
Aw, he just said, I'm very excited to go to Spain with you. Nos vamos a divertir mucho.
And that means we're going to have a lot of fun.
Sí. Gracias, Babbel.
Babbel, language for life. Celebrating 10 million subscriptions sold. Now try Babbel for free at Babbel.com. Just go to Babbel.com and start learning a new language today. That's Babbel.com, Babbel.com.
Hi, everybody. Gary Sharp for Lindley Clothing. People go, hey, Gary, what's your fit? And I usually say, not good. But then I go to Lindley Clothing, and they say, we can fit you in the best styles. They've been dressing men for over 88 years at Lindley Clothing, service top-notch, and their selection from sportswear to tailored clothing. They have me and you covered. And right now, they have you covered with a new edition of the Lindley Clothing family. It's well-suited. You can find out how easy it is to shop for you and someone in your life at well-suited top-notch staff. They'll help you find exactly what you need for prom or any special event at 132nd and Dodge in the Linden Market. 132nd and Dodge in the Linden Market. You'll find Lindley Clothing.
The Zone Hotline is powered by 42 Degrees. The Source. By your mom's house.
Hey, this big zone deal is to McSeatly Restaurant, located in downtown Omaha. McSeatly has authentic Mexican food prepared in an artisanal way and with fresh products, highlighting the original flavors of Mexican cuisine. This deal, you get two $25 vouchers for just $25. That's half off on sale this Friday at 9 at 1620thezone.com. That is McSeatly. Check that out on our website along with various other things, including get subscribed for the email list. Here is a list of things that have happened in the women's NCAA tournament so far. Obviously, we will have a star-studded night tonight. Can I interest you, Peter Mann, in a little LSU-Iowa and a little UConn-USC doubleheader tonight?
That is,
those are
good basketball.
I mean, I hope to not leave anybody out here, but those games feature the four most talked about people that we have in that game, right? We got Angel Reese, we got Caitlin Clark, we got Paige Beckers, and we got Juju Watkins. They're all playing tonight on the Elite Eight with a chance to get to the Final Four. And UConn and USC will be playing in Portland, where they had fix the three-point line, apparently, now.
Here's something I noticed.
It's really good. It's going to do a huge number tonight on TV.
I'm very excited for those games, and I'm even more excited for the fact that the game in Albany is tipping off first on the East Coast.
That seems to make sense, Peter.
And the game in Portland on Pacific time is tipping off later.
I'm glad you mentioned that.
An insane concept that, for some reason, was not considered in the men's tournament.
I still don't know if I'm totally on board with the regionals being at two places, but in this case...
Oh, no, I'm not. I think it's odd.
It certainly it helps them keep it a little bit more straight, that's for sure. But you're right.
But yeah.
Let's put the one on the East Coast starting earlier. That's 7 o'clock out there. It's 6 o'clock here. And then in Portland, you get to start it with a, 5 o'clock start time out there. It's great.
It works.
It's 8 o'clock
here.
You
would think. It just explains itself.
No. 6 o'clock there, 8 o'clock here. I see time zones are very... very confusing for me. Okay.
Why can't everything be the same time?
So here is a list of the things that have happened during the NCAA tournament. You'll notice a trend here, and let me know when you notice it. The Kim Mulkey story in the Washington Post, and she said she was going to start suing people. That whole thing happened.
And then the story came out, and it was predictably a huge nothing bomb. Amazing. Great. But there's one thing. There was a ref who got kicked out at halftime because she had received a master's degree from one of the competing universities, UT Chattanooga. That happened.
Mm-hmm.
Notre Dame's Hannah Hidalgo had to remove a nose ring during the Sweet 16 game, which she had been wearing the entire season, and they randomly started enforcing it during a Sweet 16 game, and then Notre Dame lost. That happened. There was an article that was posted that was written in the LA Times following the LSU and UCLA game that had the lead that said the following, Peter. This isn't just basketball. This isn't just a basketball game. It's a reckoning. Picking sides goes well beyond school allegiance. Do you prefer America's sweethearts or its dirty debutantes, milk and cookies or Louisiana hot sauce?
Somebody who is
not good. Yikes.
Somebody who is paid to write for a living.
Don't say that. Don't say that. Don't write that. And so, yeah, there's some undertones there that are not so good. And then, of course, the piece de resistance, the 3-point lines in Portland, where they had already hosted four regional games. It was discovered by a fan in the upper deck that they were different, and they had been different the entire time.
I've had a few drinks, but these don't look like they're the same length.
Now, hold on. Am I seeing something here? No, I mean, and to be clear, like, I had seen the court several times. I had not noticed it yet either. But when you see it, you can't unsee it, which is what most said.
Initially, when I had read that they discovered it, I was looking at the corners. I was like, oh, it's probably the corners that are off. I wasn't even looking right at the top of the key. And then once I looked at the top of the key, I'm like, oh my God.
You're right.
Once you see it,
it's different.
Very obvious.
The statement from the NCAA said, quote, the NCAA was notified today that the 3-point lines on the court at Moda Center in Portland are not the same distance. Thank you for that acknowledgement, NCAA. Like I said, there's already four other games that were played there Friday and Saturday prior to Sunday's game, which was discovered before the NC State in the women's Final Four as well. NC State and Texas, and they were notified with the countdown clock on ahead of the scheduled 12:16 start time. Video showed both coaches pacing off the distance to the 3-point. I like the coach who came out and literally did the foot by foot. He put one foot in front of the other. He's like, no, we have tape measures here. We can count all this out ourselves. I will say this though, credit to those two coaches who were just like, let's just play. They've been doing it all weekend, so let's just play through it. They said, hey, we can fix this for you. It's going to be an hour,
and they're like,
we can fix this for you. And they're just like,
we're both going to shoot on both sides of the court.
We've been doing it all weekend, and yeah, we might as well just rip it again here. So credit to those people for doing that. According to ESPN stats and information tracking, teams during the five games in that Portland regional, when the 3-point lines were off, shot 29% from the 3-point line that was too short, compared to 33% from the standard 3-point line. I would imagine that the standard deviation, like, you know, the general separation between those two are pretty close to that on a normal basis. Anyway, additionally, teams averaged 66.8 points per game from the standard line and just 62 points per game from the shorter one. So the data suggests that it did make a difference that one line was shorter. Remember, we're talking about one line being normal and the other line being shorter, not the other line being longer, but that was enough to potentially throw things off a little bit. I don't know that that's actually the case. It's a pretty small sample size, you know, but they're fixed. They're fixing it. They're in the process of fixing it now, apparently, and it will be good to go for tonight's UConn-USC finale out there in Portland.
One of six games in Portland will be played
with normal lines, with normal lines, which is really incredible stuff. It sucks. This is what the women's tournament has been all about so far. It's been about weird snafus the entire time.
We had like record ticket sales, tons of good.
I haven't heard much about Caitlin Clark yet.
I
maybe that's just been me being kind of out of the picture, I guess, for the last week or so. Obviously tonight it turns to, you know, it turns to LSU and Iowa,
yeah,
which will be awesome. And like I said, it'll do a huge number. So it'll shift over to basketball, but you still have like the court story that's in there and all the weird things that have happened in this tournament. I don't think it's hurt the, like people always be like, oh, it hurts the game. You know, it's sort of embarrassing. I don't know what it actually means, except for it probably isn't good for the sport at large when you're trying to gain popularity and notoriety and taken seriously and all this stuff. And the things that pop out from it are this kind of like horrible, weird, at the very least weird mismanagement of the games and how they've been playing.
Yeah.
You know, so it's kind of,
it screams lack of attention to detail, and
that's a good way to put it, Peter,
which is unfortunate.
Tonight though, there are a couple bangers on the women's side. Like I said, Iowa and LSU and UConn and USC, NC State and South Carolina already in, NC State in the Final Four on both.
Yeah. How about that? A good weekend for the Wolfpack.
I wonder if you could have bet that. They're friends from the FanDuel Sportsbook. I got betting brain right now. You're going to bet that both NC State men and women to make the Final Four. You probably would have got some pretty good odds on that one. Yeah. So there you go. That's what the women's tournament has been more known for, unfortunately, for them this time around.
There might be reasons for it. I was wondering, I'm curious. I might need to do my research on this. Is there that you're aware of a reason why the first and second rounds of the women's tournament are at home venues?
It's money, basically. The long and short of it is it just comes down to money. Like, it's easier travel, and you can have, there's built-in people that are there. You don't have to put, like, so when the regionals are here in Omaha, I know it's Creighton staff working it, but they put them all up in hotels. Yeah, yeah. And it costs money and all this stuff, and so that's pretty much the story.
Because it doesn't particularly bother me, but I'd be like, well...
No, I'm with you, Peter. I was talking about that last week. Like, I think it'd be cool if you made it kind of like the...
Like, everyone's on a level playing field. Yeah. Everyone's neutral, but, you know, things, money.
And it's also that way in all the other, you know,
yeah,
NCAA tournaments that we have. Like in baseball, like in the regional rounds, like if Nebraska hosted a regional, it'd be at Haymarket Park.
We'll take baby steps and get the lines and measurements right, and then we'll go from there.
I'm with you, though. And you can't, like, it's hard to disassociate the men's tournament with the women's tournament, considering they both use the March Madness logos, and it's kind of branded the same way now. But that's kind of how it is in all the other sports. Yeah. It's a cost-saving initiative, which I think probably works. All right, quick time out here. Come back. I want to talk Creighton future in a little bit. What's a kind of reasonable expectation for them? Have they proven enough to where they're going to run this back and make it look even better? Because it's just kept ascending for the last 14 years. Will that continue to happen as Greg McDermott's tenure rolls on at Creighton? That and a couple other things before we get to Sam McEwen at the top of the hour on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone. But one quick reminder for you, it's to sign up for the VIP club, 1620 The Email. You'll be the first to see all the exciting content that's going on at 1620 The Zone. I believe I got one of the 1620 The Emails over the weekend. Nick's vlog was in there. If you want to see Nick's vlogs from Vegas, they'll come right to you. It's that easy. All you got to do, put your email in right there, 1620thezone.com.
Now live on Twitch, YouTube, and 1620thezone.com.
Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. EquitableOnline.com.
What is dedication?
My daughter started making necklaces. She makes what we call affirmation fashion. I tell her every day that your black is beautiful. Your black is beautiful. And if there's anything better than being beautiful, it's being smart. If there's anything better than being smart, it's being kind. And reaffirming that every day is our method of making sure her chin never drops. My dad wasn't around, and I remember riding a bike and falling off and cutting myself, and me never just wanting to get back on it. People ask how your children learn how to ride a bike, and you didn't. I didn't teach them. I just created an environment where they taught themselves, and all I had to do was be there.
That's dedication. Visit fatherhood.gov to hear more. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Angie's List is now Angie, and we've heard a lot of theories about why.
I thought it was an eco move. Fewer words, less paper.
No, it was so you could say it faster.
No, it's to be more iconic.
Must be a tech thing.
But those aren't quite right. It's because now you can compare upfront prices, book a service instantly, and even get your project handled from start to finish.
Sounds easy.
It is, and it makes us so much more than just a list. Get started at Angie.com. That's A-N-G-I. Or download the app today.
I love playing sports, especially for my school. And that's because school sports are special. It's where it's safe to fail. It's where we're taught resilience, where our fear becomes confidence. It's where we learn to get back up after every fall. School sports are where 7.8 million students go from I can't to I can.
This message presented by the NSAA and the Nebraska State Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Roofing, siding, and gutters. Make the right call with the Rooferies at John Higgins Weather Guard.
School sports are played by humans, coached by humans, and officiated by humans. So the next time you're sitting in the stands at a school athletic event, please remember this and maintain your humanity, especially when it comes to judging and critiquing athletes, coaches, and officials. Please show your fellow humans some respect. They'll appreciate your empathy.
This message presented by the NSAA and the Nebraska State Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
The world's largest sports book in Las Vegas is available right at your fingertips in Iowa. The Circa Sports Iowa app is sports betting the way it should be. Bet anywhere in Iowa and experience high betting limits, tight money line splits, and exceptional customer service. Download your new bookie today. Visit circasports.com and start betting like a pro from anywhere in Iowa. If you or someone you know may have a problem with gambling, call 1-800-238-7633.
Getting quality employees to fill positions in your company is essential, but finding those people can be a major hassle, unless you use ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes finding quality people a breeze, and right now you can try it for free at ziprecruiter.com/radio. With ZipRecruiter, one click sends your job to hundreds of top job sites. But more than that, ZipRecruiter's advanced technology identifies the candidates with the skills you need, sends you a list of great matches to review, then actively invites them to apply for your job. And the results speak for themselves. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. That's right, the first day. Now you can focus on your business and let ZipRecruiter do the work finding the best people for you. See for yourself. Experience the ease, efficiency, and power of ZipRecruiter for free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/radio. That's ZipRecruiter.com/radio. ZipRecruiter.com/radio.
Without the ones like you who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Hey, Peter, man, you're a young fella. You know about Travis Scott.
Ah, yes.
Here's a tweet from Travis Scott.
What does he have to say?
Today might be one for the illest days in women's sports history. Let's get it.
So he'll be tuned in tonight.
He's excited. Remember, he loves Caitlin Clark.
He was in attendance at one of their games at the end of the year. I don't know if it was the record-breaking game or not, but he was there and took a photo with the team, I think.
He was, I believe he was at their senior day, at their final home game, I want to say. That sounds right.
So he must just be friends.
He loves Caitlin Clark. He loves Caitlin Clark.
I caught him on SNL this weekend. I don't really know much of any of his music, but Yeah, I saw that and I was like, well.
Oh, so you wouldn't say that you're like into Travis Scott.
No,
you,
no.
You're just a young fella.
Yeah.
So you know
I know of him.
Okay. That's good enough. That's always.
But that's really cool that he's he'll be locked
in. He says it's maybe one of the most illest days. That
that's also how I would describe it. An illest day.
It's a pretty ill day. Saw this report this morning from D1 from the D1 docket. Now take it for what you will. It is also April Fool's Day. I don't think it seems like a joke to me, honestly, but it would be a horrible joke because it would make nobody laugh because it seems like everyone would just look at it and say, oh, let's log it away and let's see you later. It is regarding the non-conference basketball schedule for next year for our local basketball teams. The season has ended and we're already on to 2024-2025. Nebraska and Creighton have traditionally met each other on a weekend day in early December. That's the way it's been over the last few years. I think they had a midweek game in there somewhere a few years ago, but they've generally settled into that first week of December. Reportedly, according to the D1 docket, Nebraska and Creighton will be playing each other on November 23rd this year. November 23rd. That game, of course, is scheduled to be in Omaha. November 23rd is the Saturday before Thanksgiving. And I immediately rushed to the Nebraska football schedule. And I thought, is that a bye week? No.
No, it is not.
Is it an away game? No. No, it's not. It's Nebraska against Wisconsin at home on that very same day, November 23rd. And Creighton will play Nebraska also that day. So maybe you'll work through the times and see what time is what. Now, this led to quite the Jayskers, they're going to be mad about this one. We'll see him in Memorial Stadium. It's like, there's almost 2 million people who live in the state. Like, there's enough people to fill up both venues. Like, it's going to be okay. But I'm more interested in, like, where the allegiance is. Like, how many people are going to be, how many members of the media are going to be, the Nebraska media are going to be making their way down to Omaha to cover Nebraska basketball? Probably zero.
Because I feel
everybody, if you cover Nebraska basketball, you absolutely cover Nebraska football.
I feel like it's got to be tough to, obviously, we don't know the times, but it's going to be really hard to pull both off because the traffic on I-80 is going to be horrible. So I just don't imagine a scenario.
There's something to bookmark there.
And we also were kind of chatting about the TV slots, how that's going to.
That's right. Fox. I mean, it's a Fox inventory game because it's a Creighton home game. Is there a place to put Fox now that a place to put Nebraska and Creighton basketball now that the Big Ten has 400 teams in it from a football perspective and they're going to cover up every window of every day on every network? I don't know. Something to think about. Just log it away. Not really an important deal yet. Just log it away. It'll be something to think about later on.
Something to note.
Future Creighton stuff. Just real quick here. So I gave you the preamble for this a little bit earlier on, and I'll go through it again. So Creighton has gone through this thing now where, I mean, I have felt like so many times over the last decade, I've had the feeling of like, damn, this is as good as it gets. And the future always holds this sort of like, man, I don't know. Like, where are they going to find a group of guys like this? Where are they going to find a group of guys like Doug McDermott and Ethan Rogge and Giants Banaga and Gregory Echenique? Like, where are they going to find this again? Grant Gibbs. And, the truth was those guys all left at the same time and 2015 was rough for Creighton. And then they found their footing again. And all of a sudden in 2016, they had Maurice Watson and they had Cole Huff and it was like, well, here comes Khyree Thomas as well. Like, they're going to figure this thing out. They went to the NIT that year. 2017 was that second year with Maurice Watson. He, of course, got hurt. But remember, Creighton was 18-1 at one point. Watson got hurt in that 18th win against Xavier. And then it was tough going the rest of the way. But you felt like the program was in good shape. And then that group kind of clears out. And then it's Marcus Foster and Kyrie Thomas and Martin Crumple, and here comes Tyshawn Alexander. And you're like, this could be a pretty good group. This is pretty promising. And that year, they are in the NCAA tournament. Then they're in the NIT the next year. And then here comes 2020. And you're like, what's this group going to be? They have some interesting pieces. Here's this Marcus Zagorowski. He's been here for a year. Tyshawn Alexander is reaching his peak. Damian Jefferson's really good. They won the Big East. And then COVID hit, and, Zagorowski got hurt at the end, too. And then that group reached its fruition at the end of the 2021 season. And then 2022 rolls around, and you're in reset mode. And who's this guy Kalkbrenner? And who's this guy Nimhard? And who's this guy Kaluma? And who's this guy Trey Alexander? That team wins a game in the NCAA tournament. Last year, they get all the way to the Elite Eight, and then this year is the culmination of it, and they end up in the Sweet 16 again. And so it just kind of kept on getting better. And I think it's fair to wonder what happens now that that group is kind of on its way out. We don't know if it's going to be a hard reset for them or if it's going to be a softer reset. We'll see what happens with Ashworth and Trey and Kalkbrenner, but I've always been under the impression that Trey Alexander is probably gone and that Kalkbrenner probably leans that way, but you never know. I don't know what's going to happen with that group. And so whether it's this year or whether it's after next, it's going to be a sort of reset of some point, and you find yourself wondering, and what does the future look like? Can it get better? And every time we've looked, every time we've turned and had to confront ourselves with that question, the answer has been yes. So my question is exactly that. Like, will they continue to ascend as a program? It's a hard expectation. Have they bumped up against some sort of ceiling? I think it's a tough expectation to say, hey, I need Creighton in the second weekend every single year. Are they Gonzaga? Can they be Gonzaga, the Midwest, and the conference that they're in with the personnel that they have and the way that they're doing it? I think it's a tough ask. I don't think it's a tough ask for them to be in or around the NCAA tournament every year. That's how I've always thought about Creighton basketball. But now the last 3 years have taken them to heights that we couldn't, previously fathom. They went to the Sweet 16 this year. They lost in the Sweet 16 round. And we thought, oh, dang, I guess they just met expectations. I'm not mad about it, but I'm not real happy about it. I'm not overjoyed with it, right? And so what does the future look like when the program, whether it's this year or next, has to reset? Do you trust Greg McDermott to the point, because he should have earned all of this by now, right? Because there's been 3, 4, 5 different iterations of these groups and now they've been to heights they haven't been before, but they've continued the ascension.
The track record's there.
Does the ascension continue, or what is the expectation? I think it's a question that I really am interested in and want to continue to dive into. And my initial read on it is it feels really hard to make the Sweet 16 every single year. I know it was damn hard for them this year. They had to kind of work for everything they got. I know they were that good, but it was hard for them to get to that this year. Hot Danger says bubble team next year. And maybe it's that. Maybe it's a little bit better than that. Maybe it's a little bit worse than that. But I think that's a good baseline expectation. You go from there. But it's like, I'm still in the mode with them where like, it still doesn't feel real to me that they are like, if they would have got through Tennessee, I would have been really trying to convince people that I think that they can win the national championship. And not to say they would have got by Purdue either. That would have been a tough game in and of itself. But I could, if they got through Tennessee, I could have seen a way through that game.
Yeah.
And then I could have seen a way through NC State. And then I could have seen a way through UConn because they did that already. Right. So, like, that's a hard adjustment for everybody's brain. I know that nobody thinks that's the expectation every year, but you are defined on your tournament success. You are defined on your tournament success. And if people decide that they don't want, they want more tournament success than just making the Sweet 16, maybe they should, take a look around and see what these other programs are doing and how difficult it indeed is to do. But I wonder what the ascension of Creighton basketball looks like from here. If there is more ascension, or if it's just, this is kind of what we are. It's a great place to settle in. You could expect Creighton in the Sweet 16, you know, twice out of every 4 years, or in this case, three out of every 4 years. It's pretty impressive. They need breaks to get to that point, but you could expect them at the, I think generally you look at a regular season team, you say, they need to be at the top of the, toward the top of the conference. If you would have told me that 10 years ago, I'd have said, really? Without Doug McDermott? How are they going to be that? And they did. And they've done it pretty much nonstop since then, with the exception of 1 year. So I think you're in between like the adjustment of them being a nationally relevant program and trying to manage expectations at the same time. Adam writes in on the text line. He says, I believe in Mac, and I think they need to win one game in the tournament every year now. It's a tough expectation. Like, need? Okay, then what's it look like if they don't? You know, they could have lost in the first round this year. Could have lost. They could lose in the first round as, you know, as a six or a seven or an eight. I don't know what people are thinking. Obviously, there's a transfer portal part of this, too, where we just don't know. We can't set expectations for anything because we don't know what the roster is going to look like yet. And then it'll go beyond that because you're going to have a lot of draft deadlines on some guys as well. So something to sort of think about and cook on for the next couple months here before we get restarted.
Forgot to mention this. I did notice the, we don't know the roster construction yet. Once guys make their decisions, but reigning Summit League Player of the Year, Zeke Mayo, has his top four, which includes the Jays.
Creighton's in a lot of backcourt guys, and they should be. So yeah, I wonder how that'll turn out with Zeke Mayo. There's some big programs in there, Midwest programs, Big 12 programs. One email from Adam before we get to Sam here. Mac didn't sign a contract extension to start losing games and just collect the paycheck. He'll reload this offseason. Smiley face. Trey and Calk come back. They aren't NBA prospects. They should look at what Baylor did in the offseason and copy that. Instead of going through the draft process last summer, Baylor spent 6 weeks with Jeremy Anderson transforming his body and working on his game. Trey and Calk didn't get that six-week window with Jeremy because they were running around participating in draft processes last year. Both of them should come back, spend serious time with training staff this offseason, transform their bodies, and see what happens next year. Maybe they work their way into a draft pick then. It's an interesting point you make on Baylor. I mean, that is absolutely the truth and exactly what happened with Baylor. And now he is a way
third
more
team All-American.
And now he's a way more attractive draft prospect. That's for sure, because of what he did with his body. I mean, like he was 1A or 1B. He was the best player in that Tennessee game with Connect. I mean, he was the guy for Creighton to get the ball later down the stretch, and it wasn't Trey. So, I mean, that's a good lesson to learn for people. Mac's approach on this has always been like, hey, whatever you want to do, we're going to support you in doing it. I think regardless or not, if they're going through the draft process and then ending up back at Creighton as a surprise, quote unquote, a little bit later, kind of like how it was with Trey last year, they'll still take him back. Obviously he's a really productive player. But that's an interesting sort of perspective to look at it from. Let's see. Pedro writes in, he asks, how many years has Gonzaga gone to the NCAA tournament? That's what I expect. They've gone, I mean, it's more than 15 years in a row now, but they've been in the Sweet 16 they've been to the Sweet 16 10 times in a row. I mean, it's crazy. So if that's your expectation, then that's a tough billing to live up to. All right, quick timeout here. We'll come back with Sam McEwen on the other side on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone. But don't forget, MLB season is back. Dingers, blasts, moonshots. If you'd like to use another word for them, you can as well. We all love home runs. And with FanDuel's Dinger Tuesdays, you can love them even more. That's right. Dinger Tuesdays are back for another season on America's number one sportsbook. Bet on a player to hit a homer, a dinger. And FanDuel will give you $5 in bonus bets for every home run hit during that game. As if you needed another reason to love the long ball. Head to FanDuel.com/Happer to get in on the Dinger Tuesday action. FanDuel.com/Happer. Once again, bet on a player to hit a home run, and FanDuel will give you $5 in bonus bets for every home run that is hit during that game. Make every moment more with FanDuel, official sports betting partner of Major League Baseball. 21 and over, present in Iowa. Bonus issued is not withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Max bonus, $25 per game. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-BETS-OFF.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio, this is 1620 The Zone.
Hi, this is Doug Nodgaard with Equitable Bank. Great service never goes out of style. When the digital age dawned, many said computers would be able to handle many of the interactions that used to take a person. Boy, were they wrong. How many times have you called your bank and gotten a recording to press 1 or 2? Not at Equitable. Not only does Equitable answer your call in the first ring, it's answered by a human being. That's because Equitable Bank values its customers. Equitable Bank, we take banking personally. Member FDIC.
You guys just didn't want it bad enough. That should have been an easy win. What were you doing out there? You got to hustle. You could have made that play if you'd been open.
On the car ride home after the game, when you think you're helping by telling me what I did wrong and what I need to work on, all I hear is that I'm not good enough, that I'm supposed to be perfect, that it's not okay to lose. On the car ride home, all I need to hear is how much you love me and enjoy watching me play, that my worth isn't determined by my performance, that even on my worst day, I am worthy, that you see me learning, growing, and doing my best, and that is enough.
This message presented by the NSAA and the Nebraska State Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Check engine light on? Take the guesswork out of your check engine light with O'Reilly Veriscan. It's free and provides a report with solutions based on over 650 million vehicle scans verified by ASE-certified master technicians. And if you need help, we can recommend a shop for you. Ask for O'Reilly Veriscan today.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Hi, I'm Kamiko, the founder of Miko's Hot Chicken. When we started our family restaurant, we were also raising a family. But let me tell you, it wasn't easy. Our Chase Inc. car was there to reward us on all of our business needs. Now we have a thriving location, and we're hungry for more.
With the Chase Inc. Business Unlimited card, you can earn unlimited 1.5% cash back on every purchase, so your business can go from here to possible. Chase for business. Make more with yours. Real business owners compensated for their participation. Cards issued by JPMorgan Chase Bank and member FDIC. Subject to credit approval. Terms apply.
Where do my friends and other students find their voice? We find our voice through the performing arts, along with millions of other high school students. By expressing yourself in a role on stage, through an instrument, or at the debate podium, the performing arts give us freedom to find ourselves, to find our place. The stage is where I can play, perform, and compete with my friends.
Performing arts at your school is where creativity meets courage. Encourage the students in your life to find their voice through the performing arts. This message presented by the NFHS, where we encourage all students to play, perform, and compete together.
Mexitli Restaurant by Chef Alberto Cardenas offers you an authentic Mexican cuisine experience with the traditional flavors of your favorite Mexican dishes with an innovative touch. At Mexitli Restaurant, they offer you the experience of tasting Mexico in every bite. The best tacos, birria, quesadillas, and more. Visit them at Mexitli Restaurant in downtown Omaha at 16th and Harney, and look them up on Facebook at Mexitli Restaurant or call 531-772-0550 to order.
Tickets for Less. Best seats, best prices, no service fees. Shop ticketsforless.com. KOZN Bellevue, Omaha, Council Bluffs. This is 1620 The Zone.
All right, welcome back. More of the Connor Happer Show here on 1620 The Zone and on 1620thezone.com. Connor Happer, Peter Krenzer producing today. And we're joined on the 42 Degrees of Source Hotline by Sam McEwen from the Omaha World Herald. Sam, good afternoon. How are you?
Good, man. How are you doing?
Good. We're transitioning now finally out of basketball, but I suppose we could wrap it up. Thoughts on Creighton and where they got to, and actually maybe what's ahead for them. I was just talking about that a little bit as well.
Yep. Just played a team that was a little better than they were on a given night. You know, I think that's all that really happened. There was a key run early second half. You know, Creighton got they got a little discombobulated.
Yeah.
Wasn't Trey Alexander's best game. That's, I think, probably going to be something that people think about when they think about his pro prospects. So that was a tough one for him. If he plays better, I think, you know, Creighton wins. But he had a hard night, and his shots didn't fall. What's next? Well, you know, they got two guys in the portal already. The way that McDermott was talking, it sounds like Alexander is gone. You know, he's going to go to the pros. It just didn't sound like he was coming back. Colquhoun has got a decision to make. I would anticipate Ashworth returning, but, you know, maybe he wants to do something else for this final year. So I would anticipate, you know, those guys coming back, and then you've got to find pieces to supplement it. And then you've got what I think is probably a five-star freshman, but the way that basketball rankings work, he didn't commit to the right team, so he didn't move up high enough.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Jackson McAndrew is probably a five-star caliber player. And if he had committed to, you know, Kentucky or something, he would be already. So, you know, what you hope is when he comes in, he's special. You know, you hope that he comes in and he's able to average, you know, 12, 15 points a game, that you don't have to go out and find that in the portal. The challenge is you don't know if he's that player until he gets in practice and he steps on campus. So, you know, McDermott has never been super excited about relying on freshmen that way. You know, he's always brought them all along a little slowly, with maybe the exception of Nimhart. But this is a guy that if he brings all the things you want him to bring, then he becomes your three. You know, he becomes your wing. And hopefully he can be all that, a bag of chips. And then Mason Miller probably moves to a reserve role. You've got to figure out what you're going to do with Isaac Trout, whether Fred King wants to stick around. I mean, he's barely played this year, so I feel like the writing was on the wall there. And then you got to get a couple of guys in the portal, you know, for that guard spot. Zeke Mayo would be a great pickup, I think, for them, for sure. You know, he's a good player. So he would be an interesting backcourt mate. Remember, you're replacing Carabello and also probably Alexander. So you need to find two guards. And I think Zeke Mayo's better than Carabello, and probably not quite as good as Trey, but he could do a lot of things for you. So yep. I'm sure they got a busy dance card here in the next 2 weeks. They, you know, when you set this standard for your program, you got to find a way to build a Sweet 16 roster. And that won't be easy if you lose Kalkbrenner. We don't know what Kalkbrenner is going to do. There's no easy replacement for Brent Kalkbrenner. So his decision plays mighty heavily in how good Creighton's going to be next season.
There's no doubt about it. Sam McEwen from the Omaha World Herald is with us. Okay, we do begin to our transition over to spring ball. We'll talk to some defenders tomorrow and Tony White tomorrow. I know I got a chance to look at him a little bit last week just for the short window. Like, is there anything that jumps off the page looking at specifically the defense, who, you know, I think is going to – there's going to be a lot expected of them this year, Sam. Like, does anything jump off the page right away about seeing the defense with your own eyes for the first time last week?
Yeah, they look great. They look like a bunch of butt kickers, to be honest with you. You know, that unit looks like it's in great shape. It's long, it's deep at the defensive line. I think the secondary is long. You know, they got some shorter guys too. I mean, Marquise Buford can't get any taller, but you know, he's got length too. They got a lot of pieces there. I think linebacker is going to be a question, but the way they run their defense, Connor, you can be a little undersized, because what they want to do is free those linebackers up to run and just go make plays. And so you're not necessarily looking for a guy that can, you know, play with his you're always looking for guys that can be 240 pounds, play with one arm free. But, you know, I think they're comfortable with a John Bullock-sized guy because he's kind of like a safety as a linebacker. So they want guys that can run to the football and hit. And so I think they're going to be okay there. But I don't think they have a weak linebacker play. But I think their defensive line is going to be really good. I think their corners are going to be long. I don't know how, you know, they're going to have to get better, obviously. And then their safety group will be among the best in the country. So their defense looks terrific. It's everything you would want it to be.
Sam McEwen from the Omaha World Herald with us. Yeah, I mean, so the question ultimately, I guess, with them is going to be, can they be that good to where they can allow the offense to kind of take its time and alleviate some of the pressure on them in the early going of the season? The schedule, I guess, helps a little bit looking ahead all the way to the fall now. But like, how, when you say butt kickers, like, what does that mean? Like, how good are we talking here on defense?
Oh, if they can build a wall against the run with their front group and make it very, very hard on you to run the football, and that they're making plays at or behind the line of scrimmage. So they have the ability to, you know, when you're running outside to make a play that's perpendicular to the line of scrimmage, which means they're flowing really well. And they're making plays behind the line of scrimmage, that their corners and their safeties are aggressive and attack receivers, play in the alley, come up the alley and make hits. You know, when you've got a, you know, quick hitch, whatever people like to call that play now, a smoke route, that you're meeting it at the line of scrimmage. A lot of those things, you know, they're going to play with on the, you know, what do you call it? Their toes. And so, you know, when you go back and you look at Bo's old defense, Bo was a read react system, and trying to confuse the quarterbacks, things like that. It was effective. But, you know, Tony White wants to play with a forward leading edge. And so you're always trying to make TFL sack, because the data tells you if you can get one of those per series, the chances of, you know, getting a punt are high. It's not a high turnover, and people just need to know that. When you play man-to-man or you play the kind of defense they played, you're not probably going to get a ton of turnovers. You might get some if you're hitting and running and all that stuff. But what they like to do is they like to bring four or five guys running as fast as they can to the ball. A lot of times it knocks the guy down. You know, the defense you want to play if you want turnovers is a zone, you know, a zone drop kind of scheme where everybody's eyes are on the quarterback. You're accepting the fact that you're going to give up some rush yards, and you're accepting the fact that you're going to give up some pass yards. But you want to create turnovers, like the Chicago Bears have that defense now. Nebraska is not really that defense. They want to get you off the field as soon as possible, and then they want to possess the football and wear your defense down. And so the way you do that is kind of play with the leading edge. They do a really nice job of that. This is my opinion. They won't ever be a real high takeaway defense so long as they're doing this. They might have a game or two where they play Idaho State or whatever, and they get a bunch of turnovers. But it's more of a recap kind of system. So, you know, I think they're going to do that. I think they're going to be very, very effective at putting teams behind the sticks.
All right, Sam. We appreciate it as always, my friend. We'll let you go, and we'll talk to you soon.
Take care.
Sam McEwen from the Omaha World Herald. We get a text here from Jeff on the text line. Whenever you talk to Sam, he's always in a crowd of people. LOL. Sam's a very busy person.
A man of the people.
He's a man of the people. And he's moving, he's shaking, he's doing stuff, but he always cuts out 10 minutes or so to talk to us. And sometimes he's in a very big crowd of people, and then we're just like, you know what? I got my pressing questions in. Move on to the next thing. I mean, it's interesting because Sam is, in football terms, Sam knows ball for sure. You know, and just looking at guys, it's interesting. And I wasn't at the open practice last week because I was probably at some other location in the country. But I'm excited to see the look of that group. And I just, it like, the question and how it's all going to come together for Nebraska football is going to end up being, how good does the defense need to be in order to allow the offense to settle into whatever it's going to be, right? Like, maybe actually, let me ask it in a different way. How bad can the offense be for Nebraska to still have a successful team, right? And I ask that question from the perspective of it has nothing to do with the offense, right? I know I just asked an offensive question, but it's not about the offense, because the question is, how much does your defense raise you up? And Nebraska's defense saved it in a lot of different cases last year. Its offense was not good enough to just meet that line or be, just carry water, hold their own. It hurt them, right? And so Nebraska's defense wasn't good enough last year to allow it to work through horrible offensive problems. My assumption, and maybe I'm an idiot for assuming this, my assumption is that the offense will completely destroy Nebraska this year, that it will be serviceable enough, and in some cases actually a plus, to where the defense can have a little bit of that edge taken off, and they don't have to do everything for this team and continually save them over and over and over again. If you get the offense to a point where it's just okay, it's just serviceable, Nebraska's going to be cooking. I'm telling you, it's not that hard. And we're talking a lot about Dylan Raiola, and I think he's going to be such, you know, I think he is such an interesting player to put in that spot at this time for this program. And you need to surround him with good players. But it doesn't, in all honesty, it doesn't have to be that great.
I think serviceable is the best word to use, because we saw a non-serviceable offense that on a team that won five games.
They still won five games.
And it came down to the last week for bowl eligibility. So, you know, we'll see.
I mean, it's a good combo. Now, the question is, you're going to have a freshman quarterback. He's going to make mistakes. But will his mistakes add up to the mistakes that cost Nebraska football games last year? Will they be like that in nature? My assumption, like I said, is no. And if you assume these things and the defense is going to be just as good, if not better, can Nebraska win 7? Can Nebraska win 8? Can Nebraska go beyond? That'll ultimately be the question. I think they have the tools to kind of do it. That's to set the tone here for spring. So they'll do, let's see, let me go back to my schedule here. They'll do some defense tomorrow. They'll do some offense Thursday. And then they'll do like a full practice and rule. We'll talk on Saturday. And we're, 4 weeks away from the spring game? Get ready.
We've reached the month of the spring game.
Spring game pregame starts now. We'll come back. Still more to come on the Connor Happer Show on 1620 The Zone. But first, Peter, I'd like to remind people to continue to get those picks in on our basketball championship tournament. 1620thezone.com. Once again, winner gets $100 to Cops in Omaha. You could also check out the leaderboard and the VIP picks on our bracket entries. Keep up with those on our website, 1620thezone.com.
Previously on Unsportsmanlike Conduct.
Chris Fetters, covering the Washington Huskies, joins us.
Gannon was in Palm Springs last night with the president of the university and the new football coach that he hired at a major donor event. Literally, that thing wrapped up, and I have to expect that right after that happened, Gannon was in the middle of trying to finalize the deal at Nebraska.
Unsportsmanlike Conduct with John Bishop and Josh Peterson, weekdays 2 to 6 on 1620 The Zone. Your Omaha area forecast from the Godfather's Pizza Weather Center and KETV News Watch 7 on 1620 The Zone.
Cloudy with mist and drizzle and cool here for the rest of your Monday, with a high today in Omaha of 48 degrees and east northeasterly winds up to 25 miles an hour. Another chance for showers here tonight. Cloudy to mostly cloudy skies, breezy again, cool with a low of 36. Cloudy Tuesday morning, becoming bright for Tuesday afternoon. Windy, still pretty cool with a high of 56. I'm meteorologist Caitlin Harvey with KETV News Watch 7.
There is only one constant in the universe, and that's change.
Brent Rasmussen of Mortgage Specialists.
I'm sure many of you remember the incredibly low interest rates that were available only a few years ago. Well, things changed. Now rates are higher. But would you believe me if I told you there was a time when people were paying double-digit rates? And that's the thing. Everything changes. Rates go up, rates go down. So if you're waiting for the perfect time when rates drop before you buy a home, you might miss out on the home you really want. So when you think about it, what's a thing today might not be a thing tomorrow. See? Change is good. I'm Brent Rasmussen. Call me at Mortgage Specialists, and we can show you all the details. Mortgage Specialists. Driven, trusted, reliable.
Click mtg-specialists.com. NMLS number 5918, Equal Housing Lender.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Hey, baseball fans, join the Blur Tailgate at Hilton Omaha this June for our 12th annual hospitality event during the College Baseball Championship Series. Book an experience for your clients or employees with an inclusive bar, buffet, TVs, music, and tailgate games. Secure your spot today and let Blur Events take care of all the work so you can enjoy the day. Plus, we're just steps away from Charles Schwab Field. Visit blurevents.com to book your group, buy tickets, or learn about sponsorships. That's blurevents.com, your college baseball and football tailgate destination.
Getting quality employees to fill positions in your company is essential. But finding those people can be a major hassle, unless you use ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes finding quality people a breeze. And right now you can try it for free at ziprecruiter.com/radio. With ZipRecruiter, one click sends your job to hundreds of top job sites. But more than that, ZipRecruiter's advanced technology identifies the candidates with the skills you need, sends you a list of great matches to review, then actively invites them to apply for your job. And the results speak for themselves. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. That's right, the first day. Now you can focus on your business and let ZipRecruiter do the work finding the best people for you. See for yourself. Experience the ease, efficiency, and power of ZipRecruiter for free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/radio. That's ZipRecruiter.com/radio. ZipRecruiter.com/radio.
Email us on the Equitable inbox with whatever is on your mind. The Zone inbox is brought to you by Equitable Bank. We take banking personally. You can hit me up, agree, disagree, tell me your thoughts on life at Hanley at 1620thezone.com. We want to hear from you on the Equitable Bank Zone inbox.
All right, welcome back. Connor Happer and Peter Krenzer with you. Baseball on the television. And it's not the Royals, because if it was the Royals, I wouldn't be able to watch it.
It's a battle of Nick and John today.
Oh,
Rockies, Cubs.
They're probably out there fist fighting each other already.
There's wagers between the two of them on this.
Nick placed some wagers on the Rockies over the weekend, I believe to only failure. He was excited about his wager on opening day for the Rocks, as you do. You bet your team on opening day. That was the day the Rockies lost 16-1 to the Arizona Diamondbacks.
And what could not have gone worse?
And then he was triggering me because we were sitting there at the sports book watching the Creighton game, and I was all freaking out. You know, I was everywhere emotionally. And Nick was like, "Ooh, did you see that? The Rockies just scored." I'm like, "No, I did not see that, Nick. Stop watching that." The Cubs and the Rockies are on right now. It looks like a lovely day from Wrigley Field.
Tiny baby letters on the Cubs jerseys. I wonder how they feel.
I bet they feel horrible, just like everybody else. The Royals were strong-armed into making their Royals.
their letters,
tiny baby letters.
The protest lasted one game.
Sad. It's sad. It looks miserable in Chicago, so that's how you know it's opening day. Best April Fool's Day joke of the day. We'll give that award out here. That goes to Florida Atlantic Football. Peter Mann, did you see what they did this morning?
What did they do? I didn't catch this.
They announced that they were going to play their annual football game with the University of Southern Florida, USF, the Bulls. they were going to be playing that game on an aircraft carrier this year. And they even came up with a graphic. It's a giant aircraft carrier with a football field in the middle. And it's really funny. And I got to be honest with you, I don't think I've gotten got like that on an April Fool's joke in quite some time, because I spent probably more than 15 minutes just logging this in my head, thinking that it was real. And I was trying to come up with a way to talk about it on the show today. And I was like, gosh, I got to say, I kind of love this for these two schools. Like, I love it for FAU. I love it for USF. Like, those two are weird places. They're always trying to find a way to gain relevance and stuff like that. Remember Bob Diaco back in the day when he was a coach at UConn?
Oh, yeah.
Came up with the civil conflict idea. Like, I kind of love this idea for these two schools.
I love it. The tweet for the location, they said floating in the Atlantic.
Floating in the Atlantic, just on an aircraft carrier. Now, there would have been if this was real, it would have been accompanied with some sort of a release, and they got all the military stuff to come with it in the uniforms. And there would have been a buzz about it beforehand, because they would have teased it 1,000 times. But no, the Battle of the Coasts will not be a thing this year.
Some quality comedy in the replies. What happens when the receiver runs too far out of bounds?
He falls off the boat. Yeah, he falls off the boat. Shark food. I think that's pretty good. He falls off the boat. See what happens after that. He's got to make his way back on there. Maybe they have a rope that they throw off, and he's got to climb his way back up or something like that. It's not a half bad idea. So that was my April Fool's Day joke of the day today. I don't usually get into the April Fool's jokes, but that one wasn't bad. I had to set a couple minutes aside to talk about this one from over the weekend as well. So there was a guy on Twitter. This would have been Saturday, who did this tweet, and I've seen it going around to various locations, and everybody's sort of pining for their region. Which region has the best food? Did you see this, Peter? The country was split into 10 regions. And
which region did we?
We ended up in the 7th region with Iowa, Kansas, and Missouri.
Okay.
So all we get is Nebraska, Iowa, Kansas, and Missouri food.
So we don't get the benefit of KC.
We do.
Oh, wait. I was thinking just Kansas. Okay. Yeah. We do get the benefit of the KC barbecue.
We do
okay.
get KC barbecue, which would be the only nominee that we would throw out there.
Yeah. I think that's about it.
So I haven't seen this very much. I just wanted to get out in front of it and say this. The region that Nebraska is in, if you're putting their food up against any, you know, all the other regions' foods, we're dead last. Dead last. We're getting last. And this is not me being like, oh, I hate it here. And it, like, I love it here. We don't have anything to offer from a signature food perspective from Nebraska except Arunza.
Omaha Steaks and KC Barbecue can only get us so far.
Exactly. What does Iowa have to offer? Here's a bunch of ears of corn and a Busch Light. Awesome. Thank you. What does Kansas have to offer? Nothing, because their best food actually comes from Missouri, and it's Kansas City Barbecue. So I apologize. I love where I'm from. I love my region. There's many great things about it. But we cannot hold a candle to some of these other, like the region that gets all the four region, which gets Kentucky, Tennessee, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Alabama, and Mississippi.
Well, that hardly seems fair.
There's no way that loses. Certainly to the region that Nebraska's in. Even the northern region with Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Michigan, and Ohio, and Indiana, and Illinois, like, they have some more stuff to offer. The way, way northeast with the lobster rolls, they have stuff to offer.
That's a tough draw for us.
It's just, yeah, we didn't get paired with great teammates. We already weren't strong, but we didn't get put in with very good teammates. So I just like to say, for anybody pining for Region 7, that Midwest region, we're losing. Like we're losing.
We'll go down swinging.
We'd be the 10 seed and we'd lose immediately. 10th out of 10.
Oh, man.
No doubt about it. Mustache Adam writes in. He says, Iowa's contribution would be breakfast pizza, but it's still not enough to move our region out of the cellar. Last place. It disheartens me to say it, but we would get literally dead last. One other person on the text line has a potential contribution here. for the 402, Dorothy Lynch. We could add Dorothy Lynch into the conversation. Dan adds, I think you're underselling the cheese Frenchie. Interesting.
Okay.
These are things that we could throw in there, but once again, it doesn't add up to anything that any of the other regions do at this point.
Charles on the YouTube.
Like, imagine if we show up to this party and we're like, all right, here's what we got. Runza, cheese Frenchie, breakfast pizza, and also Kansas City barbecue.
Here it is in all its glory, all laid out.
What does Charles have?
Charles says Dorothy Lynch disagrees, which I'm not sure how much that helps our case, but
Dorothy Lynch.
Not saying I don't like Dorothy Lynch, but you know.
Adam writes and he says, no region's beating the combination of Runza's and Kansas City barbecue. Like, look, if we were to advance at all, it would be basically like it would be like Oregon advancing in the NCAA tournament and Cousinard dropping 40 against South Carolina. It would be KC barbecue dropping 40, and somehow we beat somebody who's decent but who has a lot of holes. But I don't see it. I think we're like a 16 seed. I think we're dead last in the tournament. I think we for some reason won our crappy conference tournament. We won the. You know, we won whatever league, and
you know, we had some comments. I forgot to factor this in. Does the Reuben change our standing?
The Reuben gets in. The Reuben is obviously invited to the, you know, to the showcase, and it's a it's a great sandwich. It's a great sandwich. Does it move the needle when you combine all of the other foods of every other like? I don't think it does. I love it. It's a great sandwich.
I do love a good Reuben.
I love to get a great Reuben here. I also think they could probably make a great Reuben elsewhere. I've had great Reubens outside of the outside of our state's borders.
Are we the birthplace of the Reuben?
We're just the birthplace of it. It doesn't mean we do it the best.
Okay. I couldn't remember if it was created elsewhere, if it was right here, and it is right here.
So. Jason and Pender says Nebraska has runs at a throw into the mix. Iowa has the best fried tenderloins in the region. Poll question. I'm going to put that up
that
here.
Did not come to mind.
Iowa have the best fried tenderloins? Going to put that one up during the break, and then
time will tell on the poll.
All right. Just so you guys know, I'm sorry. It's very sad. But we don't hold a candle.
Oh, and Kool-Aid. Yeah, well, Kool-Aid to wash it all down. That'll be our beverage of choice.
Excellent. Steaks, Kool-Aid, Dorothy Lynch, all the things. All right, we'll come back. Poll questions, tell you what to watch on the other side. On the Connor Amper Show on 1620 The Zone.
Omaha's most listened to all sports radio station. Again and again and again. 1620 The Zone.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that we can give our daughters everything they need to grow and learn. But not every child can focus on classes and play dates.
Nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. face hunger. That's 1 in 6. School lunch might be their only meal each day. And it's heartbreaking to imagine any child going to bed hungry. We're dreaming of a perfect day when kids can smile, play, and just be kids without worrying about where their next meal will come from. Feeding America is working to make that perfect day a reality.
Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste. That food is given to families and children in need. Being a kid should be about doing things that make an ordinary day extraordinary. Learning to play an instrument, building a sandcastle, hosting tea parties. Hunger should never be an obstacle to growing up.
You can help end childhood hunger in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
I love playing sports, especially for my school. And that's because school sports are special. It's where it's safe to fail. It's where we're taught resilience, where our fear becomes confidence. It's where we learn to get back up after every fall. School sports are where 7.8 million students go from I can't to I can.
This message presented by the NSAA and the Nebraska State Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Host is roasting every morning. Host is roasting every day.
Since 1972, family-owned and locally roasted Host Coffee Service has been roasting the finest coffee for businesses and restaurants. If you're ready to change to a better coffee provider, it's time for Host Coffee.
Omaha's best coffee,
1972. Post Coffee is always roasting something good for you.
This message is from the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs. If you're having a tough time or thinking about suicide, you're not alone, and there's hope. VA's Veterans Crisis Line has responders who listen and help. Many are veterans or have veteran family members and friends, so they're prepared to address your challenges. Don't wait. Dial 988, then press 1.
School sports are played by humans, coached by humans, and officiated by humans. So the next time you're sitting in the stands at a school athletic event, please remember this and maintain your humanity, especially when it comes to judging and critiquing athletes, coaches, and officials. Please show your fellow humans some respect. They'll appreciate your empathy.
This message presented by the NSAA and the Nebraska State Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
We're going abroad for the first time in years. To Spain.
But we don't speak Spanish.
So we started using Babbel.
And started learning Spanish fast.
With Babbel, you can start having conversations in another language in just 3 weeks. Babbel's conversational method teaches you real-life words and phrases. And with Babbel's interactive bite-sized lessons, you'll remember what you learned.
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿Cómo te llamas?
¿De dónde eres?
¿De dónde eres?
When you learn a language, you want to actually use it. Babbel is designed with that goal in mind.
In just 3 weeks, we're starting to have conversations in Spanish.
Estoy muy emocionado para ir a España contigo.
Aw, he just said, I'm very excited to go to Spain with you. Nos vamos a divertir mucho.
And that means we're going to have a lot of fun.
Sí. Gracias, Babbel.
Babbel, language for life. Celebrating 10 million subscriptions sold. Now try Babbel for free at Babbel.com. Just go to Babbel.com and start learning a new language today. That's Babbel.com, Babbel.com.
Hi, Johnny Rogers here, and we are very excited to announce one of Nebraska's favorites, Larry the Cable Guy, will perform at this year's Jet Award April 4th at Baxter Arena. Now, here's the best news. A limited number of arena seats are available for just $39. Just $39 to see the Jet Award and Larry the Cable Guy. Now, that's over the top. Hurry and get your tickets today at BaxterArena.com. Larry the Cable Guy at the 2024 Jet Award event. Hope to see you there.
Poll questions at Happer Show on the JTech Construction Zone Twitter feed. You voted, and here is how they went. Does everyone know someone who's into black licorice? I'm going to say yes. I posed the question, and I think yes is the answer. And many people took responsibility for being that person in other people's lives.
They were proud to own up to it.
71% say yes. Question number two, is the Starburst family of products always good? This was a Peterman question. I think you're onto something, Peter. I think that's a good candy take.
I haven't had a bad Starburst product.
69%.
Nice.
Thank you. Say yes.
There we go.
You posted this one. Nice. Would you correct a grammatical error in your text message if more than 1 hour has passed? Great question.
And I forgot that iPhone now has that function where you can do it immediately. I think there's a certain period of time where you can't go back.
I believe you can actually unsend text messages now completely on iPhone.
Yeah, very. If you really screw up, you can backtrack hard.
Great question, Peter. I'm glad you asked it.
But I was thinking in terms of like sending a whole separate text with the correction.
Several hours later.
Yeah.
As one of our regents did to Trev Alberts, 75% say no. Just leave it at that point. And finally, very early returns here. Does Iowa have the best fried tenderloins? I don't know this to be the case, but I will take our texter Jason's word for it. I will say yes. As you can imagine, early returns are saying no, 75%. Whenever you see Iowa and the best, your brain just immediately wants to vote no. Those are the polls. Peterman, what are we watching tonight?
Some solid options. As we mentioned earlier, for the NCAA women's tournament, some very, very good Elite Eight action. Iowa, LSU, will be there. Are they the early game there? It looks like
Iowa and LSU is going to be.
Yes, because they're in Albany.
Yep, it's yep. 6 o'clock be at 6 o'clock on ESPN.
And then followed by UConn, USC. All of the ones and threes made the Elite Eight in that field. That was interesting.
Give me some bad. Just give me one bad TV show, and then we can call it quits.
Okay, so let's see. We have some solid options here. You know what? We'll do this because it's going to be unique to tonight. I have no idea who is nominated or what the categories are or anything. The iHeartRadio Music Awards are on Fox tonight at 7. Do I know anything going on with that? No, not really, but...
Who's nominated for anything?
Yeah, we'll see. I don't know why. You know what? Let's just look up the top category.
2024 nominees. What do we got cooking for tonight at the... let's see. Song of the Year. All right, let me know. Just give me a quick yes or no if you heard of any of these. Calm Down by Rima and Selena Gomez.
Have not heard that.
I think I actually have. Creepin' by Metro Boomin with The Weeknd and 21 Savage.
I've heard of that. I don't know if I've actually heard the song.
Cruel Summer by Taylor Swift.
Okay, yeah, everyone's heard that.
Dance the Night by Dua Lipa.
Mm-hmm.
Fast Car by Luke Combs,
yeah,
not Tracy Chapman.
Yep.
Flowers by Miley Cyrus.
Mm-hmm.
Kill Bill by SZA.
Yes.
Last Night by Morgan Wallen.
That I have not heard.
Paint the Town Red by Doja Cat.
Maybe?
Oh, you have.
I probably have.
And Vampire by Olivia Rodrigo. Yep,
that one, yes.
I've actually heard of most of those.
I have heard of most of those.
Artist of the Year will come down to these fine people. Drake, Jelly Roll, Luke Combs, Miley Cyrus, Morgan Wallen, Olivia Rodrigo, Shakira, SZA.
Oh, Shakira.
Taylor Swift, and Usher. So that is what you can expect tonight on the iHeart Music Awards.
I wonder who all will be in attendance.
Exciting. Peter, thanks for hanging out today. It's been fun.
This was fun.
Producer Josh will
return tomorrow, I was glad I got to spend the Monday with you.
Appreciate it as always. That is the Peter Man, and that is the show. If you miss anything, you could find it all 1620thezone.com. The crossover is next.
Live from the Host Coffee Studio.